Hey everybody, what's going on? Rob Cesternino here with some Survivor 41 post-season coverage, and we've got a good one for you here today because I am joined by somebody who I think is going to have a lot of interesting things to say about the season that just went by. Please welcome in Dr. Evvie Jagoda. Evvie, how are you?
Man, I am so good, Rob. Literally, this is so exciting to me. Like literally when I went on the show, I was like, no matter what happens, I'll get to do an exit interview with Rob. And now I'm doing a deep dive.
Now we're doing a deep dive. It's all happening. Evvie, you're too kind. Great to have you here to be able to talk this through. I was really looking forward to getting the chance to talk to you because I feel like that you are somebody who, and I love when I see this, is that I feel like that your passion for Survivor just like pops off of the screen.
That means a lot to me. Thank you. And it's just so true. I mean, it's just so fun. It's the best show. It's the best game. And like literally the whole time I was there, I was just like, this is it. This is the dream. So yeah, to get to talk about it with you is so fun. I can't wait.
Did we get your backstory on how you got into the show?
I'm not sure. I think I might have talked about it a little bit in my Mike Bloom preseason. But basically, so my partner's former roommate went to high school with Rourke from season 35.
Okay.
And so the two of them, my partner and her roommate, Rebecca, started watching the show then, or Rebecca had been, you know, a fan for a long time, but so they got into it at 35. And then when I started dating my partner, I think it was like season, David Goliath had just started. And I dropped in on it with them and I was like, what the heck is this? This is so good. And then I just like started binging like crazy, and seen almost everyone.
So you are in the last couple of years, but you have just gone, you know, just on a wild binge through the whole thing.
Exactly. You can become a super fan quickly if you are committed.
A lot of people do. Yeah. And so then what was your trajectory? Was it so HHH and then back to one, or did you bounce around?
So I started, so the first real one I watched was David Goliath, and then I was bouncing around. My sister came to visit, and it turned out, you know, we didn't really have any plans for what we were going to do. And we were just like, what TV are you watching? And then she revealed that she was a Survivor fan, which I didn't even know. And so then when my sister was there, we binged Cagayan and also One World. So like bouncing around between, by the way, I think One World underrated. I don't know if that's a hot take. But that's a great one.
Well, can you drill down on that? What is it about that? Is it just Kim's game, or is it anything else in particular?
I think it's, so obviously Kim's game is amazing, but compared to like Redemption Island, where you have obviously Rob is playing a great game, but then I feel like everyone else is kind of boring in that season. Mm-hmm. No offense. I feel like One World, I mean, can you ask for better characters? Like you've got a lot of crazy people there. So it's like a fun one.
You know, I don't disagree with you. I feel like that when I went back and I watched One World when we did the countdown in 2021, that I felt like it's not that bad. I mean, that I really go by how many times are you watching an episode, and it's like, oh my God, how many times are you looking at your watch? And I feel like that while like the outcome is a little bit predictable, like it's not as much of like a straight shot as it is in some of these other seasons.
Exactly. And I also feel like, I mean, well, I think it worked out well that Colton left, because that's the part to me that's like unwatchable, is the just him being so horrible. I also feel like it's not like Mike Holloway just like beasting to the end where it's like the strategy then doesn't matter. It's like Kim is still it's fun to watch, even if the outcome is inevitable. So
Anyway, so
I watched those ones, and then I basically started a chronological binge and paired it all with the evolution of strategy.
I listened
to almost all of them.
Yeah, the evolution of strategy.
Yeah, and I study evolution. So it's like literally. Yeah.
So that's probably like the hackiest thing that I could say.
I will say it's been said before.
Yes, it's been said before. Okay. You know, Evvie, could you talk a little bit more about what you do in your work? Because I put the season on to get ready to talk to you. And I said, you know, you have the first confessional of the season.
Yes, I do.
Yes. and you were talking about what you do in your work, that you study human evolution. Can you talk a little bit about like what that is like in practice?
Yeah, absolutely. So, my PhD is in human evolutionary biology. And so what I specifically study is, or what I did for my PhD. So, you know, humans spent almost our entire evolutionary history in Africa, right? And that's where, you know, the oldest human ancestors are, like, if you've heard of like Lucy or Homo erectus evolved, like all the, you know, human evolution stories you've heard pretty much take place in Africa. And then around 50,000 years ago, the first group of humans of like our species left Africa and kind of, you know, populated the rest of the world, right? But when humans did that migration, other human related species were still alive in some of those places. So if you've heard of Neanderthals, Neanderthals were still alive in Europe and Asia when modern humans left Africa and came to those places. Mm-hmm. And it actually turns out that humans and Neanderthals interbred, like had offspring, you know, did the deed.
I understand how it works. Yeah.
You get it. You're a dad. So as a result, everybody with some non-African ancestry has a small percentage of our DNA coming from Neanderthals.
Wow.
It's like small, like 1-2%. But basically what I studied for my PhD is from the genetic and biological perspective, like what is the impact of that DNA? And I especially looked at like immune system changes and things like that. And actually, like, not to talk your ear off about this, but the strongest risk factor for having a severe reaction to COVID is actually a Neanderthal derived variant. So something that I was actually already studying for my PhD then connects to COVID. So yeah, so I studied the genetic side of these things basically.
So if you have more Neanderthal ancestry, you are at higher risk for COVID?
So if you have a specific segment of Neanderthal ancestry.
Yes.
So the way it works is like different populations have, we all have like 1-2%, but you and I might have different 1-2, like the actual pieces of the DNA are different. So
yes.
It's actually a fraction that is particularly particularly common in South Asian individuals. People with South Asian ancestry tend to be more likely to have this particular Neanderthal variant that is like associated with stronger COVID risk.
Wow. I didn't know we were going to get all that. And then Evvie, like what is your day like? Are you in a lab or are you at a computer?
Yeah. So I do both things. My PhD was a lot of lab work, but then I also do like the data analysis side. But my favorite part is when I'm like in the lab doing things, and that's where I get to, you know, listen to evolution of strategy while I'm pipetting, you know. So I do both things, but a lot of lab. I grow cells in the lab. So you take like human cells and you feed them and stuff, and then put DNA in them and do experiments on them. So
yeah, that's really cool.
I like it.
Yeah. Hey, well, it's just amazing that from Survivor, we get to talk to people from like all these different backgrounds and really smart people. And so it makes it really fun to be able to, get the chance to have the opportunity to talk to somebody who's so knowledgeable.
Well, thank you. And like, so that was like the specific thing in my PhD, but I just wanted to say also that, so in studying human evolution, I got to this genetic part, but there's also elements of like anthropology and things like that, that I kind of alluded to on the show, which I feel like it's a very, the reason why I like this field is because it's science, but it's science with like this bigger picture of like human history and story and like natural selection and like all those kinds of dynamics. So it's like fun science.
You talked about that in that first confessional, or the first confessional you had, talking about what you do. And you talked about how, you study natural selection, and that's for, Survivor, that was going to be like a great spot for you. Did your actual work help in any way with the playing the game?
I would say not really. Yeah. I think like the things that, the elements where it probably came up the most were things like, something that my PhD department focused on a lot is like energy dynamics. So thinking about, when you think about Survivor and what's the best way to get calories, right? So you might think it's spear fishing, obviously, because you can get lots of calories from the fish, but you also have to consider the energy cost of doing the fishing, right? So that's like you're expending a lot of calories the chances of actually getting all those calories back is potentially low. So that was the kind of thing that was in my mind a lot of like, how can I not spend as many calories to maybe get some calories back. But it's like, did that really help me? I don't know. But I was thinking about it.
Okay. So then you started watching with David versus Goliath, which only a couple of years ago. So at what point did you realize like, oh no, now I don't just like the show. I'm going to be on the show.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. I mean, I think a lot of people, you know, the fun part about being a Survivor fan is that you watch it and you get to say, oh, well, they shouldn't have done that, or I would have done this, or I would have done that. And, you know, so I think I definitely, as I was watching, always had that in the back of my mind. But it's just something that part of the reason why I thought I would be good at the show is that I, you know, I clearly like, you know, I'm smart. I have I'm doing a PhD and all that. But I really do think like my social skills are the thing that I value the most in myself. And so the more I was watching, I was just like, I really think I could do this, you know? So it was kind of there the whole time, but I didn't really ever seriously consider applying until season 40 was on. We actually went to Jeremy and Michelle had a watch party in Boston. I think Lirsa mentioned this when she was talking to you, went to the watch party, and it was just like the funniest night of my life. Like, it was just so fun. And like, I'm not into sports or like anything like that. So I've never experienced like the communal watching of a thing where everyone's just like, literally it was sports. Like everyone's like cheering and screaming and like,
right.
And I was just like, this is the funnest thing. You know?
And if I recall that, so Jeremy and Michelle had like a joint watch party. It's like, I guess it must be like, like late February, 2020, if we only knew.
Yes, it was the last event that ever occurred.
And I believe that, and then in this, I think that Jeremy comes in and his team is losing, right? And then he comes in and has to like hit the ring toss, and he does it like it just like aces it. And it's like a come from behind victory for Selle, I think. And I just remember seeing the video because Jeremy's daughters were there, and it's just like, you know, giving like high fives to his kids. Like, I don't think they knew that they were going to come from behind and win the challenge. It's like, oh wow, what a cool moment.
So sick. And it was the episode where Ethan got voted off. So I guess that tribe went to tribal council.
It was reward. So, yeah.
It was just so crazy. And I feel like that was the perfect to go to a season 40 watch party where it's just like, you love everyone, like everything that every single one of the winners does, everyone's going to cheer for, cause you just like love them all already. It was so sick. It was crazy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you ran into Lirsa.
Yes. Yes, ran to Lirsa. I'm not gonna lie. This whole interaction is a little fuzzy
Okay, all right.
I was having a lot of fun at this party.
Let the record show. Okay.
Let the record show. But it was so fun to talk to her because I feel like Lirsa is one of the few people on a past season where I just like, it's like we would be friends. Like, you know, we're both like queer people living in this area. Like, and it was just so apparent talking to her. And she was with her girlfriend at the time and my partner was there. And the four of us, it was just like, yeah, like we would be friends, you know? But it's Lirsa from Survivor, you know? So it was just one of those moments of like, I really could be on Survivor. Like, you know, like this is a person just like me, you know, obviously different in many ways as well, but like someone that I really could see myself in, and she was on Survivor. So like,
yeah. And then what did you do? Did you go, you made a video?
I made a video. So I think the timing, the whole COVID timeline there actually was a huge part of it also, because so like I said, my PhD was a lot of lab work, and I was like so close to being done with it, and then COVID hit, my lab shut down, I had to like literally throw out all my experiments, and I was just home for like, I think from, you know, March till June or something of 2020, no one was allowed to go to the lab, and I was just like honestly pretty depressed. Like, it was like I was so close to finishing my PhD, and now I'm just like sitting at home being scared and sad. And I was like, fuck it, I'm gonna make a Survivor audition tape. Like, that's what I'm gonna do to like have fun during this time. And it was like, I think everyone around me was like, oh, that's just a fun thing Evvie's doing, making this audition tape. But I was like, I think if I make the I think I'm gonna get on. Like, I don't know, I had a confidence in it. So
mm-hmm. Now, you said that your partner is also a big Survivor fan. Did she ever consider making a video to apply?
So yeah, we were both thinking of applying, but her thing, she's very, I mean, honestly, she would be better at it in a lot of ways than me. Like, Carmel is very good at like, she's always lying to me, like in a cute way. Like she mm-hmm. always just like in the middle of a conversation will say something that's just not true and then be like, no, just kidding. I'm like, what mm-hmm. fuck? Like, why? But like, so she has like a lot of, she's really good at that. But a lot of, she also has a lot of sensitivity around like sleep and things like that. So yeah. that's the thing that's holding her back is like that she would just die from the sleep situation, which is real. The sleep is not good. I know
sleep
you
is not good.
Sleep is fine for you on Survivor, but
yeah, for whatever reason, you know, and that I just am gonna like pass out after like you know, a certain point. It's gonna be a hit a certain hour, and I'm gonna pass out, and that's just you know, I think how I am. But you know, when it's you know bad weather and stuff like that, there's a lot more that you can't control about it. But,
yes.
All right. So you get the call yeah. that you're going to go. And so this was part of the show that your incredible preparation was on display.
Yes,
and
yes.
to the point where you were hacking challenges. How much research went into your prep?
Yeah. You know, so I did do a fair amount. I mean, like, here's the thing is like, I am not good at puzzles. And like, this is like, if I go back on Survivor, it's going to haunt me because everyone now thinks I'm good at puzzles. But like, look at those Yasa challenges. I was always on the puzzle and we always lost. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I'm like not inherently good at them, but I knew that like, obviously they're a huge part of it. So to me, it was all about like, what can I hack? What can I learn? And that's like how I do school also. Like, I'm not necessarily going to be the person that everything comes the most intuitively to, but I'm going to like work really hard and read the textbook and then like copy over the textbook again. And then I'll like get an A on the test, you know? So I did a bunch of research, obviously also had like fire making and all that, but there's a lot of amazing, like shout out to all like the Survivor puzzle Etsy stores. Like I think there's one out, like Outplay Puzzles or something mm-hmm. like that, where I ordered a bunch of puzzles from there. So I was practicing at that all the time. But yeah, the one that actually turned out to be the best, I know this is a podcast for most people, but I have here the beads.
Well, we're already doing the video. And so yeah. I can go full screen on your video.
Yeah. So I showed these to Erica when we got home. She's like, you won that puzzle from your old lady pearl beads. just like, okay, Erica. but yeah, I literally made this one the freaking day I was packing for Fiji. Like I was leaving the next day and just had that on. I was like, gonna practice it, and it turns out to be the only one that was useful, so you just never know.
Yeah, I mean, it was like an incredible poll because so that was in the Edge of Extinction, right? And then yeah. I don't think and then it did come up on 39 or 40 again.
I don't think so. Oh, and I since we're on this, which I know this is nitty-gritty, but like I think people have interpreted on the show, I said I remember that tribe was sucking at the challenge and then they aced the puzzle. That was the point I was trying to make, that they were doing bad but then they came from high end. One, I think people like Lauren O'Connell tweeted like, glad we were so bad, Evvie, LOL.
Yeah.
Like, no, you were good.
I mean, Evvie, you know, in fairness, you know, like, you know, we have the tapes, you know, I don't think you were wrong in either
yeah,
way.
Exactly. I mean,
They struggled,
but then they did that puzzle. I'm like, that's the kind that's worth hacking, where it can just really be like, this would take 1 second if you just know how to do it, you know?
Is there anything to sort of like, okay, that they will bring something back from like two or three seasons behind? Like if somebody was going to go play in season 43, should they be like looking at stuff from like 39, 40?
I would guess so, honestly. I mean, just like on the logistical level, they probably do just like, you know, keep stuff around. I don't know what the storage facility is on this Survivor things, but you know, it makes sense. But then also, I don't know, like my season also had a lot of
new
challenges, like the crazy merge challenge, which was, I don't know if anyone told you this, but after that challenge, John Kierhofer came in and told all of us that he, you know, he's John Kierhofer is the designer of the Survivor challenges for years, came in and told us that was the hardest challenge they've ever had on the show. Like that, it was.
So this was the basically the one where you get divided into the groups of six and have
yes,
the giant
and had
with
the giant ball.
Hey, Evvie, like, look, when you have a challenge like that with huge stakes that are going to really matter, you gotta make it the hardest challenge ever. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, you gotta make it the hardest challenge ever because ultimately the losers will win. So. Yeah, like imagine that. How frustrating that is. It's like, wow, we won the hardest challenge that they ever had. And the result is we get screwed.
Mm-hmm.
So,
mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah.
All right. Well, let's talk about the actual game. And, you know, is there anything you want to like highlight from sort of like, you know, it must have been such a thrill to go. And you talked about this in the first confessional about we got to be in the first season back. What was that like to be a part of, like, okay, finally, like I'm sure there were a bunch of maybe starts and stops along the way. What was it like to actually get going?
I mean, it was so cool. And I mean, so I'm one of the, I don't know if you call this like lucky ones or whatever, but so I applied, like I said, I applied in 2020. So I thought I was applying for season like 43, 44. Mm-hmm. And then to find out like, no, we want you now. And you're going to be part of this first season back. It was just, I was just incredibly honored. Like that's the only way I can describe it. Especially like, you know, they put in the diversity requirements and wanted to have 50% POC. And then to be, you know, a white person that gets to be a part of the season, like I really was like honored that I got to be a part of this particular season, because it's just, it was so obvious to me like that this is going to be, I mean, it's like corny, like, but new era, like it really is. And to have like a more diverse cast and, you know, more like culturally aware, like that's what I want to be a part of. So it was like, I already wanted to do Survivor so badly. And then to find out that it gets to be like this momentous season of the first season back and you kind of this, you know, new culture of the show. I was just so, so excited. From the second, like, I remember we were just like all, you know, in the airport flying from LA to Fiji, and we all obviously have our masks on and whatever, so you can't really see anyone. But I was just looking around being like, we're all going to be on Survivor. Like this is like, it's just the whole time, just like it never got old. Like this is actually happening, you know?
Was there anybody that gave you like a really strong first impression, good or bad?
Well, Xander had an N95, you know, the real
yes,
one.
Yes.
And he had one strap on and one strap kind of dangling. And I don't know, that just stuck in my mind. I was just like, put the strap on. I don't know. You know, a little mask etiquette. But you know, he had it on. Like it's fine. He got through the airport.
Yeah.
But in the whole pregame, I will say Tiffany and I were always like near each other. Like our rooms in the quarantine were like right across from each other. So like when they would put food out and we'd like open the door, we'd like look at each other. Mm-hmm. And it's like we're not allowed to obviously talk or anything. It was like, you know, like yeah. So she was on a run. And I also in the pregame had a very, I will say, honestly, I think this to some degree hurt my game, is that I had a very good like smile relationship with Deshaun. Like I felt like I liked this guy. And like, you know, I think that was maybe the feelings were possibly too warm going into the game, because I just was like, I like that guy, you know, and you gotta, you know, you don't want to base it all on a smile. You gotta feel him out, but we can get there. We can get deeper into that.
Okay.
Well, and then of course, Sydney was rocking a bikini the entire pregame. Like never was an article of clothing on her. So, you know, she lays it all out there.
Yeah. So it talked to me about Three Tribes versus Two Tribes. Did you feel like that Three Tribes was going to be better for you than a bigger group like 9 or 10?
Yeah, no, I was actually pretty worried about Three Tribes, because I was thinking, I feel like my weakest part of my game is my physical game. Although, you know, it ended up being that I felt like I was pretty fine in all the challenges, but I was definitely saw the writing on the wall of if it becomes a keep the tribe strong situation, that's very, very bad for me. So like that was always the thing I was very worried about, of getting out really early for being weak on my tribe. So I felt like in a tribe of, you know, 9 or 10, I'm unlikely to be the first one out, but maybe in a tribe of 6, I could have, I was more likely to be that target. So I was very much, I felt like on a tribe of 10, I could hide for longer. But on a tribe of 6, I just like, I knew I had to take control of the situation, or that's at least what I felt, because I just felt like I was way more at risk in that, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So talk about your, you know, experience of like, okay, finally now we're going to get the game going, and, you know, here's your group. And it was not a great start for Yasa.
No, it was not. And I think in those first couple challenges, like, you know, it's obviously lost, but like you have to, we lost so bad, like disaster loss. I mean, in the marooning, we never even got off the freaking boat. So like, it was like, okay, this is bad. Like we're going to be the disaster tribe. But so right away, looking at the group, even just like right after the marooning, my thought was like, it really, because again, I'm just so worried about this keep the tribe strong situation. So I, in my head, I'm looking around and it's very obvious that the three guys, you know, Voce and Xander are both like super built. Abraham's kind of like got an old school, like he's very strong vibe. So it's like very clear to me that those three could be like three, let's do guys strong. And yeah. I knew for sure that Tiffany, like I just got the vibe, okay, Tiffany's going to be with me. Like, I feel like that's obvious that she would go with me over the guys. So I was like, Liana is the most important person. If I can, because Liana is really strong. Like in the, like when we ultimately do jump off the boat, she's the one that like swam and got the final oar. Like, it's very obvious that she's going to be seen as one of the strong ones. So if Liana goes with the guys, that's like game over for me. But if I have Liana, then it's guaranteed that it's at least 3-3, and then we can go from there. So like right away, I was like, she's the most important person to making the situation like how I want it. And also I really liked her. So like it worked out well. But I quickly identified like that's the linchpin, you know?
Mm-hmm. And I think it was something that it was kind of a back and forth in terms of like, you know, how this alliance or how this group was going to shake out. Once you got there, like, was there really something there with, you know, Voce or Xander, or, you know, how much were you just like stringing those guys along?
Right. I mean, so I honestly do think that choosing to do the sweat challenge was kind of a detriment to them, because that just like is really shitty to be, excuse me, to be like gone from the
Voce tribe. Knew it.
Yeah, he knew. He was totally, I mean, he was totally right. Like, mm-hmm. And because, you know, I think it probably would have gone in a similar direction anyway, but just like to have all that time where they were gone just made it so easy to be like three girls like done. And
what should he have done, Evvie? Because he said that I can't say I don't want to do it. I'll look like a weenie.
I honestly, he was in a bad spot because it was so clear that Xander wanted to do it. Like when we were having this, like he was like, let's go. So it's like, he would be kind of shunning Xander if he didn't do it. Also, if he had pushed for us to do the puzzle and then we lost the puzzle, that would have been really bad for him. So I don't know. He was kind of.
Could he get Abraham to do it?
I don't think Abraham could have done it. I love Abraham, but it was like very tiring. Like, mm-hmm. I think he was screwed. I don't know. I think Voce just got himself into some tricky stuff. I mean, I think, yeah, I honestly don't know. I don't know what he could have done. Like, mm-hmm. I think the other thing is like, maybe, I mean, and I think he did a good job when they came back from the sweat. I think both of them did, you know, a good job of like integrating with the other people. But I think their biggest mistake was letting Abraham go. I mean, like, obviously, I mean, of course, it worked out great for Xander overall in the game. I mean, you know,
sure.
You can't criticize, he made it all the way to the end. But mm-hmm. I think like that was a big mistake that they, I don't think, realized like how much control they were letting go by letting Abraham go. And, you know, a lot of that was like some personality conflicts. Like, I think, you know, Voce is very, you know, he's a surgeon. He's used to being the guy that tells everyone what to do. And he's actually not like bossy, but he clearly has an opinion, you know?
Yeah.
And Abraham also has an opinion. And so it's gonna, it was easy for that those clashes to come about. And then it was super easy for someone like me to just like,
so,
you know,
Voce
them.
And Abraham were not getting along.
I would say in general, Abraham just was like a little bit, didn't mesh as well with everybody. But I think Voce really was getting annoyed. mm-hmm. Like there was some, I forget. Yeah. There was some, like, there was a time, like Abraham did a lot of great stuff. Like he built our fire pit, like himself, but he was always, that was kind of the vibe. It was like, we'd be working on a group task and he would kind of be doing something else. And it's not like the something else was bad, but it was just like, he was just kind of not on the same page a lot of the time.
Mm-hmm.
And there was one time where I forget what he wanted to do. I think he wanted to like tie together the bamboo on the shelter. Like our, you know, it was like, we don't need to do that. Like that's not like a useful like energy, again, it's all about the energy conservations. Like that is not something that's worth it. But he kind of like roped the guys into doing it with him. And Voce was like very like muttering under his breath and like, I don't want to do this. But it's the classic Voce. He doesn't want to do it, but he does it. But then he's annoyed that he has to do it, like with the sweat challenge.
Yeah.
So it was just like a lot of situations like that. And like as they're kind of being together and kind of bickering a little bit as this is happening, it was me, Tiffany, and Liana like took our palm fronds and went out onto the beach and were just like laughing and bonding, the three of us. So it was just like very easy to like make that situation happen.
And what happened with the flint with Abraham?
Right. Well, so that's the other thing. And I just also want to say, Abraham is so nice. Like, he's so nice. And he, like, even seeing him after voting him out, like, he's so, so nice.
Yes.
But so the guys come back. They just worked for literally, like, hours and hours to get the splint. And also, they had both been talking in the boat when we were, like, paddling, like off the marooning, like, about how they both have practiced making fire from just bamboo. Like, they're clearly, Voce and Xander are very excited to make the fire. And right away, Abraham's like, I'll try. Like, he's the first one that's going to try. And it's like, okay. And again, everyone's being very polite, so no one wants to be like, no. And just literally first hit, the striker breaks off from the magnesium.
Now, did he do it wrong, or was it a faulty flint?
I actually think it was a faulty flint. Like, that's not supposed to happen.
That's not supposed to happen, right?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, you're supposed to be able to, like, hack this thing, and it won't do that. Yeah. But it wasn't a good look. It wasn't a good look. You know, like, this is why, I mean, I know how to do it for, like, I practiced a bunch at home, but I never wanted to be the one, like, I don't want the situation where all eyes are on you. And if you fuck up, everyone's going to see it. And I think Abraham didn't think about that outcome. Like, yeah. So it was not a good look.
This is vindication for that. You know, when I heard, like, oh, he broke the flint, he must have been really, like, doing it wrong. If you do it one strike.
Yeah, yeah. No, I don't really think it was his fault, but it was, you know, very easy to rag on him. Yeah.
So that, I guess what I'm thinking about is that, you know, you had these two guys, Xander and Voce, that they just got done with the sweat challenge. It's like, okay, we brought home, everybody check it out. We got this, we earned this flint for the tribe. And Abraham's like, all right, let me see that. And then he breaks it, like, first shot. Yeah. That was it for Abraham. That those guys are like, that's it. You broke our flint.
I honestly think that was probably it for Abraham. And it was the combination of that they had earned it and they wanted to be the ones. And then instantly he breaks it. You know what I mean? Like, it just was so bad for him.
Yeah.
And then, like, you know, then proceeds hours of people trying to continue making the fire with the broken flint, which is super hard. And actually in that time, it broke further, and there was, like, one big piece of striker left, and then it was, like, getting really dark, and Xander dropped that, and then he, like, so he, like, lost the essential remaining piece, but then he didn't really want anyone to know that, but I noticed it, and I was like, it's okay, man, like, I don't know, we had a thing building, like, it was a total mess, and it was just like, Yasa is a disaster.
Yes. Did Yasa end up getting a different replacement flint along the way?
We did. Jeff took pity on us and they gave us a new flint,
which I think
is further validation of that. It wasn't really Abraham's fault. But again, not a good look, not a good look.
Okay. All right. That's it for Abraham. And he ends up going out, and then
I think what informs the next vote is also related to something that was missing from the first episode. So it was very set up, like, honestly, from, like, the first day, that Abraham would probably be the first one to go on our tribe. Like, that was in the works early. But there was definitely a remain, once they announced once Jeff told us about the shot in the dark, then it's like, you know, amps up the stakes, because I feel like it had been pretty obvious that Abraham was on the outs. I think ultimately he just felt really good about his philosophy of, like, well, obviously we have to keep the tribe strong. So, you know, he got lulled on that. But everyone's brain starts turning when Jeff announces the shot in the dark, because if Abraham gets any inkling and he plays it, you know, what's going to happen?
And that came up at Tribal for the
first
time?
It came up at Tribal. Jeff told us about the shot in the dark at the challenge.
Okay,
at the immunity challenge.
Got it.
So when we're, like, transporting back from the challenge, my mind is, like, racing about how do we deal with this situation. And right away, it becomes clear that the way you solve it is you can always, if one person throws a vote on someone else, then if Abraham does play his shot, Because the situation we're worried about is everybody votes for Abraham. Abraham plays his shot in the dark. And now there's, like, a no vote, re-vote.
Like the
situation.
Idol. Yeah.
Like the idol. So that one would be fine if everybody did vote for Abraham, because then there would only be five people voting and the three, me, Tiffany, Liana, will have the majority. And that would be fine. But what if one of the guys gets nervous and puts a vote on one of us? Then it could be a 1-0. You know, you have to kind of now consider exactly like the idol situation. So it pops into my head that the way to solve this is if it seemed like Tiffany was going to be Abraham's target. So if Tiffany were to put one vote on Voce or Xander, then we'll be safe no matter what. Because at the worst case, one of those guys could put one vote on her or something, and then it's a tie, and then we could re-vote and we have the majority, right? And so that is also immediately apparent to Tiffany. And this is when I, like, because before that, I was definitely thinking, like, Liana is my, like, going to be my number one strategist. Like, we're going to do this whole thing together. But Tiffany was the one that she and I, like, simultaneously were like, Tiffany needs to put a vote on vote share. Like, and I was like, okay, I like the way Tiff's thinking. Like, we have the same kind of instinct on that. And the thing is that Voce was also like nervous about this. And he was saying to me, should I put a vote on Tiffany? So he he's the one that's like the paranoid thinking through the options. Meanwhile, Xander spends the entire day just making Abraham feel like Abraham is good. Like we discussed this plan of like, we're gonna pretend, keep the tribe strong. And Xander's like, cool, got it. And hangs out with Abraham like the entire rest of the day. To my knowledge, like, misses this whole circulating thing of like, is Voce going to put on a vote on Tiff? Is Tiffany going to put a vote on Voce? Like, ultimately, they both decide to not put votes on each other, which I think was like really nice for the whole fake tribe unity situation. But it gets to the point that like right before tribal, right before we're leaving, Tiffany just goes up to Voce and is just like, Voce, don't fucking vote for me. and he's like, I won't, like, you don't fucking vote for me. And she's like, okay, done. And then neither of them put votes on each other. But so it became clear to me that like, Voce is thinking, you know, a lot.
Yeah.
And is much less likely to be contained in that way, you know?
Mm-hmm. Evvie, you must be feeling so good at this spot where that you're 3 days in. And really, like, you know, you were concerned, like, oh, what if I get in a tribe of six people? I'm going to know where to hide. You are seemingly running the whole tribe.
Yeah, it was so exciting. Like, after that first tribal, I was just, like, so happy. Because I knew that, like, I had just done it. Like the situation for me going forward was going to be so much better than what I could have predicted for the pre-merge. So, yeah, I was so ecstatic and happy. And I was also like, oh my God, what if I get the fishy for that last episode? Like, I was like thinking about that. And then
did you?
Yeah,
you did.
Yeah. So wow. Pretty good. So yeah, no, I was so, so excited. And it was just so clear because also like you have to remember, we were so bad at that marooning challenge. And then we were so bad at the immunity challenge. Like, I don't think they showed how far behind we were on the puzzle. And like, it really seemed like we were going to be the Matt Singh, you know? And I just really felt like after that first vote, and then especially after the second vote, I would definitely be one of the two people to come out of our tribe. Yeah. So I was like, that was my whole goal for this whole six person situation is like, you can't just like take it easy. Like, you have to make sure you would be one of the two if it gets to two.
Right. Right. Yeah. That's a good note in terms of like, cause we talk about this about like, should you do the intentional Matt Singh? I think you were very much prepared. You weren't going to throw the challenges, but if it gets down to it, I mean, look at Ricard and Shan, who they ended up like coming out of like their situation in a great spot.
Exactly. And I think that's right. I was never going to intentionally Matt Singh. Like, it's obviously so scary to go to all those tribals, but you have to prepare for the unintentional Matt Singh, right? So it seemed very much like, yeah, I need to make sure that I would be one of the two. And then honestly, I do think like, I mean, I went into the merge having really good relationships with the other three people on Yasa and still like it, you know, it got super messy and we like fell apart. And I think if you think about like Uwa, if they had gone into the merge with like, after the JD vote and like you had like, or after the Brad vote where like JD is like feeling like he's on the outs, you know, like it is much messier when you've had two votes than when you're down to two, you know, like, so I think there really is something to be said that like, when you get down to two, you've now like eliminated all the fractures in your group and you know what I mean? So, you know.
I don't. Well, yeah. Evvie, you're talking me back into the intentional Matt Singh look at Luvu. It wasn't like that going in. I know Erica's going to go on to win, but it wasn't because they had so many Luvu numbers that they were able to like just like exert their will on the rest of the group.
But you know what? I think what we've seen in the three chats is the middle tribe is the one that gets screwed the most. Like Yasa's the one that really like I feel like fell apart completely. We're like the what was Penner's tribe on
Okay, well, I didn't know there was gonna be a Survivor trivia. Tandang, and it was, and then people are gonna,
I know.
I have to say it in Calibur. I have to say it in Penner's voice. Yeah.
Calibur. Yeah. Exactly. Like they were the ones that get screwed. I think it's the middle one because even like Lulu obviously was prepared to turn on each other, but they also were prepared to like, we could stick together for a little longer, you know, and that's kind of what happened at the merge. They were very much prepared to go at each other. Like Deshaun is throwing everyone under the bus. Like the first thing that Sydney says to me is, I want to flip on these people. Like, is like, I feel like I got jittery in my video, but can you still hear me?
I hear you perfectly. The video has gotten a little like stilted at times, but your audio is coming through perfect.
Cool. Anyway, so yeah, they were prepared to turn on each other, but they were also prepared to totally fall back on the Luvu thing. And then in the end, for the first couple of votes, all of Luvu did vote together, you know? So I think you'd rather be, you've got to be the Luvu or the Ua is really the key there.
No half measures. You're no all in measures. Or all out. Yeah.
No half measures. But, you know, like, and that's the other thing with the intentional max thing. I mean, you have to be really freaking confident that you're Malcolm's niece, you know, or you're Shannon Ricard. And like, I was pretty confident that I was going to be one of them, but I also like, I felt good about my other three tribe mates. So like, I didn't want to really lose anyone. But ultimately I think their internal tensions was rough. It was rough for me in that.
The second episode is when we start to get the beware advantages.
Yes.
And this is a very Yasa heavy episode because we're going to be dealing with Xander is going to have the advantage. You're going to go to Shipwheel Island. Ultimately, Tiffany has the thing with the balance beam. Voce is going to get voted out. So a lot of focus here on what's going on at Yasa. I guess start with Xander. Now, we didn't really talk about Xander going to Shipwheel Island. And you talked about how you felt good about Xander going to Shipwheel Island, and he came back with the extra vote, and you felt like, okay, well, we know where this is.
Yeah. So I, in general, felt like right after they came back from the sweat challenge, me and Xander had a conversation where I felt really good about him. Like he was like, I like you, I like your vibe, and I was like, same. So we kind of had our relationship started there. But so Xander, like, a thing he was doing the whole game was implying that he's going to use his advantages for other people, which basically never ended up happening, which is fine. But it's just like funny that was so like in that before he even went to Shipwheel Island, he said to everybody, if we find an idol, let's use it together. Like, okay. And kind of like put everyone on the spot a little bit of like, that's what we should do, right? Like, that's a great plan. And it's one of those like awkward Survivor moments where you're like, no, fucking of course not. Like, of course I'm not going to do that. But like now someone has said that that's what we should do. So we have to be like, yeah, of course we'll do that, you know? But so it was like this, and this is kind of the whole thing I feel like with Xander in general, where it's like, he is a really nice guy. He does intend to be like, you know, loyal in some ways, but he also like a little bit overdoes it in a way where you're like, can I trust that? You know, like I felt really good about him. And then he's like, let's use the idol together. And I'm like, is that genuine? Like, that doesn't, why would you say that? You know what I mean? Like, it's just suspicious, you know? Mm-hmm. So when it came time to pick someone to go to Shipwreck Island, he had already said, I'll use the idol for anyone on the tribe. So that's kind of, so when it was like, who should we go? I was like, well, Xander said that thing of sharing advantages. So he should be the one to go. And everyone was like, okay. Cause clearly like whether or not that's true, that's what he's going to be putting out there.
Yeah.
You know, that's what he wants us to think is true. So in some ways, that's kind of the same for now.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yes. And then also we're going to get, so Xander's going to find the beware advantage. And now you are, you know, seemingly sort of like playing both sides where, you know, you have the thing with Tiffany and with Liana, but also, hey, I also am going to make Voce and Xander feel comfortable. And Xander feels comfortable enough that he shares with you the beware advantage.
Exactly. And so that was obviously amazing. I was like, this is happening. He's telling me this is great. But obviously it's like so scary to think now he has an idol, he's an extra vote. You know, you kind of see my thought process there, which is like, now's probably the time to get rid of Xander. But the other thing is that I did always feel better about my relationship with Xander than my relationship with Voce. Like, just Xander gives off a much more like trust, you know, like yeah, the, all this stuff of like, let's use the IELTS together. Like he's just, and like with the way he was with the Abraham vote of just like being like, okay, fine, I'm just going to accept this. Whereas Voce was much more like scheming and thinking through all the options and like getting worried. So, you know, I started the day thinking, okay, we definitely need to blindside Xander. But like, as that cycle went on, I think there's like a missing day in the edit, like the whole day five. Because basically what happens is, so, you know, as you see, I tell Liana and Tiffany about the advantage. They're like, okay, we definitely got to blindside Xander. But I'm thinking, basically, what I think I'm getting a little greedy in this moment because I have really good relationships with everyone. I'm thinking about it like I have four allies. And if we go to tribal, one person has to go home. But I would like to end up with three allies. You know, like I would like to only have to lose one person from my, you know, of people that trust me. So, so I'm trying to think, if we are going to blindside Xander, can we get Voce on board in some way such that we don't leave Voce totally, like totally blindsided and upset, you know?
Yeah.
Can you still hear me? I think.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Okay. Cool. One of my headphones died, but that's fine. Whatever. Anyway, so I float to Voce, like, wow, Xander's got a lot of power, you know, just kind of like taking his temperature on where he's at with Xander, knowing that Xander, because he obviously knows that Xander has the advantages. And Voce's like, yeah, that is like worrisome. But he's also, Voce's also like, but I don't want to end up in a situation where it's me and the three women, because he's like, that would make me nervous. And I was like, that totally makes sense. What if we bring in Tiffany? Because Voce and Tiffany are very close, like on a personal level. And so Voce is like, yeah, that could probably work. So him and Tiffany have some good conversations. And I'm thinking like, okay, maybe this will work, that we could just get Voce to go along with this plan and still keep Voce for me, like in my back pocket or something. But as this cycle goes on, Voce gets more and more nervous about the situation and ultimately tells Xander that he's worried that like, that it's maybe the three women are together. Like he's just starting to like freak out and not go along with this. But Xander comes, so there's this moment where like, I have this fake alliance, but you know, I have this alliance with Voce and Xander. And at one point, like, the three of us are all sitting on the beach or on this, like on the boat we have like laying on the beach. And it's just like silent. Like Voce clearly has something he wants to say, but doesn't want to say it in front of me. And I'm like, this is very bad. I don't like the situation. So actually I think in the episode where I say to Liana, like, I'm nervous, that was about Voce, not about Tiffany. Like that's from the, like, I was starting to feel like Voce is getting very paranoid. So I float to Liana and Tiffany, maybe we should get Voce out. I think he's like more of an immediate threat than Xander. And they were like, no way. We need to get Xander now. He's got the advantages. We have to get him out. So I was like, okay, fine. I'll go along with my alliance. Like either way, it's fine. But so that's why when I went to Chippewa Island, I was so convinced like we're definitely going to vote out Xander, because I even said, let's vote out Voce, and they weren't down. So that's why I'm like not concerned at all about giving away all this information about Xander, because it's like, I mean, I'm the one that wants to keep Xander and they don't. So why would we keep Xander? And then, of course, I come home and it's flipped around.
So going into the challenge, I think it was just an immunity challenge where Xander is going to say the first of the beware advantage phrases. Did you all workshop that at all, or he just was going to leave it to Xander just to blurt it out?
Yeah, I don't remember. I think he just went for it.
He did a good job.
He did a pretty good job. I mean, it's definitely like, Tiffany likes to joke that it's something that Xander would say. And I think that's like kind of true. Like, he just went for it and was like, okay, something profound that Xander is saying here. You know, like, it worked great the first, I feel like the first two times it was great. You know, like, but honestly, I mean, compared to like Brad, he crushed it. I mean,
yeah. I think he had maybe an easier one. I think that was also like the middle difficulty of the three phrases.
Yes, the goats on AstroTurf. I mean, that's easy. Like,
yeah.
Confused is a great easy emotion to work in. I don't know. Yeah. I actually think butterflies might be the hardest, because broccoli, you know, food. Like, I think the way that Shan did it was great. You know, like, I'm vegan, I'm starving, I can eat anything, but like, butterflies, are there even freaking butterflies? I mean, I guess, yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't know. Are there butterflies in Fiji? I haven't seen them.
Yeah, I mean,
not
I don't
on
remember
TV.
Any.
Yeah.
Yeah. But maybe I just don't have any dead ancestors that want to say hi, you know?
Yeah. And just hope they're not Neanderthals, right?
Exactly. Or hope that they are, you know? I love Neanderthals.
Okay. Evvie, you went to Shipwheel Island.
Yes.
And you talked to Deshaun. And yes, people were very divided over, okay, good gameplay, bad gameplay to give Deshaun so much information. You said you feel warm towards Deshaun. He's got a great smile. Who could not open up to Deshaun?
I mean, it's true. But so like we have to remember the situation that I'm feeling. We have now just lost horribly the first three challenges, like the marooning, the immunity challenge, the second immunity challenge. So like I feel very, very confident. Like it never occurred to me that we would never lose again before the merge. Like the idea that Xander was going to come to the merge was very unlikely to me, because it's like, I felt very, very confident that he was going to go home that round. And if not, he would definitely be the next one to go. Cause like, if we lose Voce, we're not going to win another challenge. We're not going to win a challenge, but of course that's not what happened. So, I mean, definitely that, you know, was riskier than I had thought, but given all the evidence that I had at the time, like it was so likely that we would get Xander out before this, you know, came back to bite me. Mm-hmm. But the other thing is that they didn't really show anything that Deshaun said to me, you know? And I, because to me, like the information to me that was the most important was that I had, that like me and Liana and Tiffany was the core alliance at Yasa. Like that was to me like the big secret, you know? Mm-hmm. Because that's like the thing that reveals like my whole game. And especially like, no one really, like me and Liana especially, like we were so close and we kind of like kept distance from each other a lot at Yasa to kind of like hide that. So like to me, like how close me and Liana was like a key critical secret. I was just gonna say, but Deshaun, the thing that he said to me, which I think was like a very revealing thing, was he told me that he was closest with Sydney and Danny. Like, so, and that was true. Like that was his like core Luwu alliance. I mean, he also had, you know, a good relationship with Heather and Erica. Like he had a lot going on, but like he told me Sydney and Danny is a thing and him, Sydney and Danny is a thing. And to me, that was like, that's the real secret, is like, who are you actually loyal to in the game? So I felt like he was telling me his whole game as well, you know? Yeah. I just had more to give, but I didn't tell him my like things that were most important. So anyway, I honestly don't think it was that big of a mistake. I just think it was like maybe one risk too far.
And so that you felt like there was like an even amount of information sharing going back and forth.
Yeah, to some degree. And I also think the other thing is that I was like legitimately, I saw how much, so I felt I really want to work with Deshaun. I really want Luwu on my side. And he told me, he's like, I'm going to go back to camp and I'm going to like talk to Sydney and Danny and say like, Evvie's cool. Like I was very worried I would go into a swap and be like swap screwed or something. So I was like really like counting on Deshaun to give me an in with, you know, these six people that seem like they're going to go deep in the game. But then the other thing is I had seen how bad it was for Xander to find the idol. Like he found the idol and then lost all his power for the entire pre-merge, you know? And so I really didn't want that to happen to Deshaun. So that's also partially why I told him, because I told him like the mechanism.
Beware.
Like literally beware. Because I didn't want him to lose his vote and maybe get out. And then my, you know, my lifeline, I felt like would be screwed.
So you come back and then basically find out that, okay, Tiffany is saying, okay, I don't want to put a vote on Voce or Xander, because what if he has a thing?
Right, right. So it was very frustrating that she didn't believe me about how it worked. Like, I felt like it was like, Tiffany, she kept being like, you don't know, he could be lying. And I was like, I read the paper. Like, it was very frustrating. But the other thing is that I kind of more wanted Voce out anyway. Like, because to me, again, I have this good relationship with Xander. I'm more worried about Voce being paranoid. And very critically, Voce is closest with Tiffany, like on a personal level. Like I felt like Voce and I had a good strategy relationship, but him and Tiffany are like going to Aqua Dump together. They're like fake, like husband and wife. And like, so to me, it was like so silly that Voce did throw Tiffany out there, because she could have been the one to want to keep him the most because they had a good relationship. So I was like, if we get Voce out, I am clearly everybody's number one of the remaining people. You know, whereas if we get Xander out, I don't know where Voce necessarily stands. So it very much was fine with me. The other thing is that,
that Liana is the holdout, though. She wants to get, why aren't we getting rid of Xander?
Right. And I mean, and I think the other thing is that if Liana and I had just gone forward and been like, no, we're voting Xander. Now we leave Voce, who I don't really trust. And we've now pissed off Tiffany, and Tiffany and Voce are close. You know what I mean? That just seemed like a worse overall outcome for everybody. Mm-hmm. But obviously Liana, like, I did not know how much she was going to hold on to this. And to me, it's like, you know, seeing her say like, that was my $1 million mistake, not voting out Xander. It's like so frustrating to me because I feel like her $1 million mistake was thinking that it was her $1 million mistake. You know what I mean? Like, I think holding on to like that this was such a big deal was the thing that made it a big deal. But if she had just been like, whatever, it wouldn't have been a big deal. You know what I mean?
Yeah. That's interesting.
Like, yeah. In the know-it-alls from that segment, you guys talked about the how kind of it was similar to Steven and Joey Amazing in Cambodia.
You just call him Joe.
Fair. Agreed. I feel like it's very like that situation because I feel like Steven, the problem became when Steven was so obsessed with getting him out that became so, so important to him that it put blinders on the rest of his game, you know?
Yeah.
And I feel like that's exactly what happened to Liana, where it was so important to her, but it wasn't like, Joe never won Survivor. Xander got to the end and didn't win. Like, it was never as big of a deal as she thought it was. But in thinking it was such a big deal, it made it a big deal, you know?
Yeah. How do you know in the real time that it's not that big of a deal?
First of all, he still has no vote. You know, it's like, what is he going to do right now anyway? You know what I mean? We could still always lose a challenge and vote him out like, extremely easily. That's number one. Obviously, for me also, I have a good relationship with him where I feel like I can use him for myself. I mean, and the other thing is like, I mean, Xander was always saying this. He's like, I'm a big shark with my fin above. And like, Liana's a secret shark. Like, he said that to me a bunch of times. And like, he says it in the episode, you know? And like, that's the thing. It's like, there will always be a time to get out Xander. I mean, in the end, there wasn't. But it seemed like it was always like, we could always be like, look at that guy. He's obviously great at challenges. And, you know, like, let's get him out. Like, it just felt like it was always available. Like, we're not going to necessarily forget about Xander. I mean, and the other thing is just like in the scheme of just like the amazing people on my cast, like everyone has such a good story. Like Nasir on the boat being like, I learned English from Survivor. Like it was just like so clear that this cast was full of like people with amazing stories. And Xander just doesn't have, like he's, you know, a 20 year old college student. Like it just wasn't that scary. You know what I mean? It just never scared me that much.
I guess the scary thing from Liana's perspective is, so he has an idol that is not able to be used, but at some point, like he could get to turn this thing on. Now that for your sakes, that the other tribes were, you know, not able to find the idols and say the phrases in the amount of time that would have given him a live idol had you gone back to tribal council.
Right. Well, so. And that's obviously true. And like, because at this point it became a situation where Xander did feel threatened by Liana, and he felt really good with me and was like warming more and more to Tiffany. So from Liana's perspective, it was probably the scariest because if his idol was activated, he's going to vote for Liana. Like if we lose again, but that's what he's thinking.
Yeah.
So clearly that puts her in the worst position.
Evvie, one of the things I was wondering from this vote was that what did you message to Xander about what was going to happen? Did he know it was going to be Voce?
Yes. I'm so glad you asked me that because he knew. So even from, you know, I told you there was this middle day where Voce was like freaking out. And Voce tells Xander, like, I think they're coming for you. Like Voce is like freaking out. And Xander comes to me and is like, Voce is pissing me off. Like he's so paranoid. He's like making this day so stressful. And I'm like, I totally agree. Should we just get out Voce? Like, you know, we don't need him, you know? And Xander's like, that's fine with me. Like Xander, so Xander, even before we lost the challenge, was fine with it being Voce. Meanwhile, and didn't tell Voce. Meanwhile, Voce was already freaking out and telling Xander. So it was just very obvious to me, Xander is going to go with the flow on this. And so, before the vote, it was like, Xander, we're doing Voce. And he's like, totally fine. To the point that like, he didn't even have a vote. And yet when Voce gets voted out, he's like, man, I feel so bad. Like, I interpreted that as he felt guilty that we all voted out Voce, even though Xander didn't even have a vote. So Xander was like very much a part of that. And that was like also the narrative we were saying is like, okay, like we've lost two, but like the four of us, like the four of us have voted together this whole time. Like, you know, we're a four. Obviously then a week went on where we didn't lose and where fractures like came more and more. But I felt like at that point it was like, at least we've like preserved this, that we could be a four, you know, in this moment.
Evvie, personality-wise, did you get along with Voce? Because I think coming into the season, a lot of people pegged this as, oh, okay, well, first off, you made a big stir with your bio, in the pet peeves, men. And then people felt like, oh, Evvie is not going to be able to stand this guy. But we didn't see that on the show.
Yeah, no. Honestly, I love Voce. And we like that's the funny thing about that. I feel like people took that so seriously, my pet peeves men. Like, the point I was trying to make is that, you know, know-it-all-y people, no offense to know-it-alls.
Yeah, but, like, was that a shot? Yeah.
It was not a shot. Okay. It was not a shot. But, like, that sort of energy is annoying. Like, and often it comes with men, but not always, whatever. But the thing is, I'm also extremely experienced with that type of person. Like, you know, that's my life, is like being around really smart, like scientists and things like that. So to me, Voce was like a very familiar person and is not a know-it-all. Like he's honestly a great guy. But to me, like I was thrilled with Voce because I'm coming in thinking I'm getting a PhD at Harvard. That is gonna be so threatening if anyone finds out. I don't want people to know how smart I am. Voce off the bat, hi, I'm Dr. Voce, I'm a neurosurgeon. You know, I was like so thrilled that he existed because I just got to be like, man, Voce's a neurosurgeon. Like he's really smart. Like that's so scary. Like we got to be scared of this guy, you know? And so no, he did not annoy me at all. I mean, honestly, he's a wonderful, wonderful person and we're friends and everything. So no, he's great. But when you said 16.667, I was like, yes, like bury yourself under the
that is the correct statistic.
Oh, no.
Yes,
yeah, no, that's so dumb. Like Jeff said 17, that's the same thing, like you're just rounder. But it's so funny, I was just like, thank God I've got this guy who's just gonna step out in front and be like, I'm the smart one, like I really like Voce.
Okay, good. All right. After that happens, okay, so now Voce is gone, you're down to four, and it's looking so bad for Yasa. Everybody's like, what, how could they win another challenge? And you'll never go to another tribal council until the merge.
Right. And so, like, this whole time, we set up this fake alliance, basically, of trying to get Xander to think it's me, Tiffany, and Xander, such that if he does get his idol, and we do go to tribal, he will, like, he'll vote for Liana, but it won't matter because we'll all vote for him. You know, like just trying to make him feel very complacent, or that he won't play the idol, right? That's obviously the key point. And so what's hard about that is like that whole thing is designed to protect Liana, right? Like we don't want him to idol Liana out of the game. But like, because we had to keep this facade for so long, it
hit her more and more.
Well, hold on 1 second.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Yes.
Oh, sorry about that. So it just made Liana so frustrated that she had to pretend to be on the outside for so long. And even more than that, I think the thing that pissed her off the most is she was like, how can Xander believe that I'm this passive? Like, because she was always like, you know, when Xander was around, she's like pretending to be off on the side and she'd be like, does he buy it? And we're like, yeah, he buys it. She's like, why does he buy it? Like, how could he think that I'm just going to like sit and like be on the outs? So it's like, that just like frustrated her to the point where she's telling Shan, like, I'm on the bottom of Yasa, which is so not true. Like she was never on the bottom, but she just like, it just made her so mad, which I like do understand. Like, and it was a long time, but it's just like, what's so annoying? Cause it's just like, that's not what's happening. Like, you're fine. Like, we're fine. Like it's not, you know,
you had this, you had the whole thing under control seemingly, and then, but for Liana, she can't see that. She's not in those conversations. She doesn't know. And ultimately, what if Evvie is snowing me? What if this isn't true?
Right. And it's like, I don't think she actually necessarily thought that, but she was just like, you know, you see it in her game. Like, she wants to be the one to make moves. And I totally understand that. Like, it's easy for me to say as the person who had the most control that this is fine. But like, I get why it was annoying to her, but it was just like, it's good, Liana, that he's underestimating you. Like, being underestimated. Look at Erica. Like, that's how you freaking win
the game. Look at Erica. Yeah.
Like, you know, like, so it was like, take this. This is amazing. Like, you're being underestimated and you're so much stronger than you think he thinks you are. That's perfect. Like, that's the ideal situation.
Yeah.
But I
kind of get it from the Liana perspective in that, you know, you get just like beaten into you. Like, hey, you got to make big moves if you want to win. Like, you can't just coast. If you get to the end, you need a resume. And if she's feeling like, what am I doing? I'm just sort of like laying low and just, you know, going to let Evvie handle everything. Right. How am I going to win? Maybe I'll last, but I won't win if I stay on this trajectory.
Totally. And I totally understand that. It's just like, we weren't voting. Like, what are you going to do?
So in hindsight, would you have considered throwing a challenge and then just sort of like, okay, we have this squeaky wheel, let's just execute on this plan and get it down to the core three.
Right. I mean, and definitely like that was on our minds. But the thing is we were just really not sure when the merge was going to come because this is like totally uncharted 26 day territory. Mm-hmm. So like it definitely occurred, but then it's like, well, what if we're wrong that this is the last challenge and then we just lose again and then have to vote out one of the three of us?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it just always felt like too stressful to do that. And then it's also really hard for me to say because in the end, like Xander's idol bluff was essential to me staying in the game. So I just don't know how that all would have gone down.
Yeah.
You know, so it's really hard to say. I honestly feel like I don't have any regrets about that situation. I just wish that I could have I wish that I could have comforted Liana more and made her feel like not have her not feel that way, you know? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And to go back to the Survivor know-it-all thing, it's like, I don't have the answers. Like, I don't know. Like I am legitimately like asking these questions when we watch the shows back and it's like, what should they have done? Like, I don't know. I'm just really curious to know if you felt like that, like looking back, you felt like a strong way that, you know, there was something different that you could have done.
Right. Yeah. And I just really don't. I mean, the other thing is like, it was already starting to freak out people like Danny and Deshaun, like, Yasa has a women's alliance, you know? And like, if we then also voted out Xander, like the only thing I had to prove to them that that's not what was happening was to be like, no, Xander was part of all this. Like, I'm great with Xander. Like, we're a thing, you know, was like my only like even way to pretend that it wasn't that. So I think it would have not been great to get down to just the three of us, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. This is when Yasa are the turtles. I feel like that this is, you know, peak fun Yasa, right? You're having, you're doing sing-alongs.
Yes. I mean, okay. Also something that I feel like was not shown on the show is I think people think we had like amazing weather for the whole pre-merge. It actually starting like even I think on day like 4, it rained at some point every single night. And I just that didn't make it into the show. So like we were suffering a lot, but yeah, we had like, it was also like very fun and like wholesome. Like, yeah, we were like, we would sing, we like had our little rock band going on. There was also this whole hilarious thing. You remember in the challenge where we won that like fish?
Yes.
Okay. So we have the fish and we, you know, we clean it and eat it and we have left like the guts on and the fish head on a rock. And we wake up the next day and we have all this energy because we finally like ate and we're like, oh, we should have saved the fish guts because then we could try to fish with them. Like it was, we had this idea.
Or you can make it into a stew.
We'll have to get to the stew because I have thoughts.
Okay.
But so the next morning we try to fish with these fish guts, but we don't have like a net or anything. We don't have any fishing gear. But what we do have is that Abraham had left his underwear when he got voted out.
Okay.
So I end up filling Abraham's underwear with the fish guts. It smells obviously horrible. So I'm like wrapping my
from the fish guts. Justice for Abraham.
Justice for Abraham.
Yes.
Oh, yes. Yes. Not the underwear. The fish guts.
Yes.
Yes. And so I had like wrapped my buff around my face. Like Liana and Tiff did the same thing. We've got our like buffs around our noses. Xander's like, well, I just imagine a piano concerto and then I can't smell it. Which is like, this is why Tiffany thinks that the butterflies thing wasn't crazy. Tiffany turns and is like, what did I do wrong with my kids? They don't talk like that. My kids never talk like that. So we are like, it's like, we don't catch anything, of course, but we're having this like fun day, you know? So like, we had like, honestly, this period of Yasa was like probably my like peak fun part of the game. We were just like being ridiculous. Yeah, so it was very fun, you know? And then, yeah, then the whole baby turtles thing, and just like, we're living the dream. Like, we're just like out here winning challenges and seeing baby turtles. And it, I mean, it was very fun.
Can you speak to a little bit about the conditions and the amount of food that you had? Because Evvie, you know, on the show, you all talk about how it's hard of season.
Yeah.
And how there's nothing to eat, and how that nobody's had it worse than the season 41 contestants. But then, you know, I have to talk to all the alumni, and then yes. I have to hear about how, well, back in my season, blah, 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 blah.
Yes. Yes. Okay. I fully, freely admit there is no way for me to know what the hardest season is because I only played one. Okay. And mm-hmm. I also know there were other seasons that didn't have rice. Okay. Mm-hmm. Apologies mm-hmm. to anyone out there that was offended by any of that. But I do think, I mean, I feel like it was explicitly a goal and was the outcome that we all lost the same amount of weight proportionally to if it had been a 39-day game. Like, I watched Christian Hubicki's Ponderosa video recently.
Yes.
He was voted out on, I think, like day 30 or something like that. And he lost the same amount of weight that I did. And I was only in the game for 17 days.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it's like, and that is objectively worse for your body. Like, I think like maybe in terms of the mental situation, longer is always going to be harder. But in terms of the body, like when you're losing weight at like, you know, times 2/3, like, you know, like if you're losing the weight faster, mm-hmm. that's just mm-hmm. very, very damaging for your body. So it was just like very instantly you have no energy. And like, it was, I mean, I said this to Jeff at our first travel council, like we were literally like dreaming of white rice, you know, like that mm-hmm. would have been like the best thing ever. Like there were many days where we ate like literally nothing on Yasa. And the really good days, Tiffany was actually like amazing at catching crabs. Like,
yes.
It's so funny because you're just like talking to Tiff and she's like, bop, 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 bam. And she just leans down and like picks up a crab. Like she was the provider truly. And so if it was a day where like, especially where she caught a crab, we would each get one leg of a crab and it would be like, this is the best day ever. Like we're fed. It's like, it was bad. Like it really, really was bad. And for me, I got my period on day 2. I hope this is an okay conversation for you.
It doesn't come up much, but wherever you want to go, Evvie.
I got my period on day 2. And that's like, now it's like your body's already so depleted and you're literally like losing so much additionally. So starting mm-hmm. on that, I actually like threw up every day of the pre-merge just from like run down body situations. So like it was freaking bad. Like it really, really was. Yeah. So, and that's like, not to jump ahead, but like when you start thinking about like, obviously I wish that I had been immune at the merge, but eating the merge feast was really, really good for me. Like I was like very not doing well body wise. And after the merge feast, I like never felt that bad again.
Yeah.
So, you know, food is very real. It's just very hard to like, I think, communicate it to the audience.
We didn't spend a ton of time with Yasa in the period in between the second vote and then when you ultimately get to go to like the fake merge. Are there any other like highlights from that time?
Yes, I think the one scene that I just really wish they had shown was, so we're after after we win, you know, what ends up being the last challenge before the merge. It seems like very like it has to be because now Uwa is going to be down to 2 people. Like it's got to be the merge now. And so me and Tiffany tell Xander, because like, remember, Liana is now at Shipwheel Island with Shan.
Mm-hmm.
And when she's gone, me, Tiffany and Xander are discussing, you know, what are we going to do going into the merge? And Tiffany and I are very trying to say to Xander, let's be Yasa strong. Let's stick together, the 4 of us, you know? And Xander's like on board with that. And we're like, you should tell Liana about the idol so that there's like unity. But of course, Liana has known about it the entire time. And so when Liana comes back from Schiphol Island, we have this just hilarious conversation where just like every single person is lying in some way. Like Xander like tells Liana about the idol and he's saying that he just found it, which is a lie. Liana's pretending that she doesn't know, even though she's known for so long. And me and Tiffany are pretending like we just found this out, even though, you know, we've known for this whole time. So we're like, we're pretending to Xander that we're pretending to Liana, but like actually we're pretending to Xander. Like, it's just like one of those like Survivor like standoffs where just everyone is like kind of putting off of a front. So I just thought that was funny. But so that's kind of like, that's what we're trying to do, is be like, we're a four, even though obviously not everyone felt that way.
Mm-hmm. All right. The merge is eventually, quote unquote, coming. Okay.
Yes.
You reached a point. Did at the time that you got to when it was going to merge, did you feel that, okay, this is it? This feels like time? Because I know that you are the first group to go through the 26-day experience.
Yes. I mean, it definitely, like, it was bad. Like, I remember there was, because, you know, the game is going so quick because we're skipping a lot of the down days to make the 26-day happen. But there mm-hmm. was, like, a full down day between the immunity challenge where ultimately, like, Jeannie went home. And then there was a skip day. And then the merge challenge was the next day.
Oh, interesting.
So that day, I think that was day 11, is this the off day, was torture. Like, we were just, like, please, please, please let it merge today. Like, we are dying. Like, this is the point. It's now like rained a lot. And so we had lost our fire and everything was wet. So it was like really hard to get it back. So it was like, is it even worth it to like build a fire? Cause we don't even have any food. Like, it was just like really, we were very, very depleted. So I think it felt like what it's supposed to feel like when it is the merge. Mm-hmm. And then also keeping in mind that UWA now has two people left. It's like, it's gotta be. But I also like, isn't it crazy? Cause if UWA had lost the challenge where ultimately Voce went home, they would have been down to one person. Like, I was just, mm-hmm. I was so convinced that it was going to be the cycle before that. Cause I was like, how could they set it up such that one tribe could get down to one person? But I don't know. Yeah. Maybe it would have been a Stephanie, an Oolong situation.
Yeah. They would have had Ricard and Shan making fire.
Yeah. How crazy would that have been?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they can't get enough of people making fire on this show.
It's true.
They love it. Okay, so all right, you're gonna go to the big merge, and yep. Ultimately we're going to draw our rocks, and you end up with a pretty good squad, Evvie.
Yes, I mean, I was so excited in terms of a challenge because I was like, okay. We definitely got this.
Yeah.
But it was also,
it felt good going in. Cause it, yes. Just reset it. So let me see if I can remember. So it was you, Ricard,
yep.
Danny, Deshaun, Nasir and Erica were sitting, they sat out. Yep. And then was there, I guess Sydney. Yes,
Sydney. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And Sydney like is so strong. Like that, it was completely stacked, that team. Mm-hmm. And it's like, looking at our team, I'm like, that's great. And looking at the other team, I'm like, yeah, this is great. Like, because the other team is, I think, Heather, Tiffany, Xander, Liana. Am I missing mm-hmm. someone? Oh,
Yeah. Okay.
I felt like we had it. And not that those people aren't athletic, but like, it was athletic and also like strength. Like, digging the ball, like, was just horrible. So, mm-hmm. yeah. I mean, I was the weakest link on my team. Don't get me wrong. It's not because of me that we won the challenge. But
how long did the challenge take to dig the giant ball out?
The digging was long. Like, it was, and it was like both a lot of digging involved, and we were just like all so depleted. Like, I also just really wish there was an amazing Jeff challenge call that didn't make the show where he's like, Heather's digging sandcastles out here.
Yeah,
I don't really know what that means, but you know, so it went on for a long time, but yeah, ultimately, I mean, it was really impressive that the yellow squad made it up the wall. That was really like impressive.
Yeah. And so ultimately, all right, then somebody was going to go to Exile Island, and that person, it was going to be Erica. Did you, like, as a student of the game, like, you know, give any thought to like, well, Will this person that goes and gets exiled come back with something?
Yeah. I mean, I think we all assumed that there would be something there, but I just like, you know, in my head, the biggest thing there could ever be is an idol. Like, it never, right. I was operating under linear time, Rob. Like, I did not know.
You did not think there was time travel.
I did not. So, you know, definitely underestimated Jeff on that one. Mm-hmm. But yeah, so But also to me, it's like, I don't care. Like, I don't know Nasir or Erica. So it's like, either way, I'm just going to go with what happens, you know?
Yeah. Okay. So then your group wins. You go to the merge feast. What was the spread at the merge feast?
Oh, it was so good, honestly. There was like a ton of fruit. And the thing that like I had been craving was like prosciutto and like melted cheese. Like,
oh
yeah, that's, and I grew up kosher. So it's like not mm-hmm. great, but that's the thing that I like, but I was literally dreaming of that the whole time, and they had it. And it was like this brie that like just completely melted from just being outside in Fiji. That just was like, so good. And like a rotisserie chicken and like pesto. Like it was legit.
Legit spread for the merge. And so at that time, you know, the scene that or the thing that really like caught people's attention was where Danny talks to you about that, you know, I forget exactly what he said, but basically he's asking about like, is it seems like that there's a woman's alliance.
Right. And yeah. And very much tried to deflect of like, no, I'm with Xander. Like it's the four of us. It's always been the four of us. But, you know, I doubt that he really, really bought that. I was so shocked that he said that, because it's like, why would you say that? You know, like, mm-hmm. like what am I supposed to do now that you've said that, you know? But the whole thing, honestly, the whole merge, it was just like, it was pretty awkward, I would say, because it's like, there was not, I feel like sometimes when you see the merge piece in when it's like everybody, there is able to be a lot more like side conversations and like secret conversations or like people going off together. But it's like, there was only seven of us. So we're just like, or six or whatever. And we're all just like at this one table, you know? And it's like, I feel like when it's everybody, like this happened on Yasa too, and it was the four of us, like it's always like inherently a little bit awkward because you can't really talk strategy because everyone is there, you know? Mm-hmm. So it was just like, I don't know. It was like weird.
Did you feel like you were making any bonds with people there? Because there's nobody else there from Yasa. Only Deshaun is the only person that you've interacted with before in the game.
Right. Yeah. I felt like it went pretty well. I mean, I was sitting next to Sydney and I felt like we had a great like rapport going on. I mean, Sydney's freaking hilarious. I mean, you've talked to her. Like,
I recall. Yeah.
I felt like that was good. I felt like Danny and I had some nice, like we had that little awkward moment, but also had a lot of like fun banter. Like I really liked Danny. So it felt like it went well, but it also, again, because everyone was there, everyone was sitting at this one table together. It didn't feel like anything that important could happen because there's, you know, everyone's like in front of each other. Like even with Deshaun, I was like, I really want to like actually talk to him, but I can't really talk to him because everyone's here, you know?
Yeah. How about Ricard? I don't really recall anything from the show where you and Ricard were, you know, talking strategy or anything like that. Did you have any sort of relationship with Ricard?
Yeah. So, well, first of all, like, and not to like get into thorny stuff, but like the first thing I said when I got to talk to Ricard was like, I'm glad you said what you said about come on in, guys. Like honestly, that was like my biggest, it was so, I was so happy with the ultimate outcome of like what he said and everything. But like my biggest regret about that whole situation was that, if you remember, so, you know, on the marooning, I said,
oh, I recall. Yes.
I don't know if you know, there was a whole thing about this, you know? So I said, you know, guys, it's fine with me. Then 2 days later, Ricard is like, actually, I think we should get rid of it. And I just so wish Jeff had passed it back to me so that I could just be like, that's great. I'm so glad Ricard said what he said. You know, like it just left this like awkward thing where it was left like we disagreed, but we don't disagree. Like I completely agree with everything Ricard said. I was just speaking from like my experience, you know?
Empathize with what you're going through in that spot. You know, I think that you're probably saying I don't want to be the person who's like saying like, hey, let's on the first day, like, everybody's saying like, hey, no, that's a classic phrase. You know, you're sort of saying like, it's fine, you know, it's fine. It's fine with me.
Right. And for me, I felt like, and I think this is like, well, you know, was to some degree in my own head, but like, so I've talked to Jeff. He knows that I'm like very like political and like an activist and queer and like a feminist. Like I felt like Jeff was wanted me to say, don't say guys anymore.
Don't put that on me.
Right. And like, I'm not like, obviously that's in my head. Like, I don't know what he expected to happen, but I felt pressure on it. And my instinct was to be like, I don't want to be that person on day one on Survivor, like you said. Mm-hmm. But then I also didn't, I also totally think we should have inclusive language. And so like when Ricard said that, I was like, this is good. Like, let's get rid of this. But I just hate that like it was left such that like we disagreed on it, which we don't, like, you know? So yeah. I felt like talking to Ricard, I went out of my way to say to him, like, I'm so glad you said that. I agree with everything you said, you know, and I got to learn more about his family. And, you know, I didn't know that he was queer, like, until that conversation. So, like, getting to, like, you know, learn more about him was, like, we connect about this. Like, this isn't something we disagree about. But yeah. but the thing with Ricard is he's very, I mean, him and Shan, it's such an interesting thing, the two of them, because Shan is so warm. Like, she just exudes that warmth that is, like, so seductive. Ricard very much keeps his cards close to the vest. So I felt like every time I talked to Ricard, I was like, I like him, but I really don't know how I stand with this person. So I think it makes sense that he was able to like do really well in the game, but also that like I think a lot of the UA people, you know, felt so much more connected to Shan than him, because he's very like, you can tell that there's more going on than what he's saying, you know?
Yeah, that's very interesting to have, you know, the sliding scale of Shan to Ricard. Where do you feel like you come down? Are you closer to the Shan side of things,
yeah,
or the
I'm
Ricard?
I'm much more close to the Shan side. I mean, I really saw it like me, Shan, and Deshaun in the pre-merge. I feel like we were all playing the same game with our own personalities. But like, I think the three of us are very, you know, warm, charismatic, social, like wanting everyone to, you know, to like us, you know, have that thing. And you know, it puts you, it's very obvious when you're that person also. So it's like a risky spot. But I definitely, yeah, feel like I'm on that end of the spectrum.
Okay. Back to the camp.
Yeah.
And now there's going to be some talk, I would imagine, of, all right, well, here's the group that's going to, because you had what, a night or two nights, I think. Even.
Yeah, so there's a whole day. Yeah.
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 Where Erica is on Exile Island, and that is she the presumptive person to be voted out?
So I think it very much went back and forth between being Heather or Erica. Like that whole cycle, it was like, it's going to be Heather or Erica, and it's just a question of which one of the two of them it's going to be. Which was so interesting, because it's like, yeah, like Luvu came out of the gate throwing each other under the bus. Like Sydney's... The first thing Sydney said to me was like, ugh, I hate Heather. You know, like, I called her a B word, but only because she was being a B word. But she didn't say B word, you know?
Mm-hmm. Just for the record, that's, you're still not supposed to do that.
Call people a bitch.
Right. That is a faux pas. Yeah.
It's not my survivor strategy. You know? It's iconic behavior, I would say, on Sydney's part.
Yes.
But I don't know about it. Mm-hmm. But so, yeah, they're just really like throwing each other under the bus.
But can I ask you a question about Heather? Because I feel like that, you know, she's somebody that we really didn't get to know very well as a viewer.
Right.
I mean, is that imagined from Sydney? Was Heather just pushing Sydney's buttons?
Yeah, I mean, I think that like that was just a two of them personality clash. I mean, there was the whole thing with the dream of Heather's dream. So I think that was like a lot about those particular dynamics. I mean, Heather is like a very nice person, mm-hmm. but she also can be a little bit. And I really like, you know, Heather, and we talk outside of the game and stuff. But she can be a little like when she said to, you know, in that scene after that tribe, when she's like, Evvie, what did I tell you at tribal council? Like that thing, mm-hmm. where you're like a little bit like putting someone on the spot.
Yeah.
I feel like Heather does that a bit, like going into that tribal at the merge. I remember she said to me like, Evvie, tell me the truth. Like, did you throw my name out there this morning? Like that kind of thing of like putting someone on the spot. That's never going to be how I operate in Survivor, because it just makes a person uncomfortable. And
right.
I'm always trying to not make people feel uncomfortable. But, you know, she got to final four. So it's like, you know, or whatever. So no, I think that was a two of them issue. But she does a little bit do that thing mm-hmm. of people on the spot.
Yeah. But that's interesting that, you know, Sydney, who I guess, you know, she has personality issues with Heather and Nasir and maybe Erica, unclear on that. And she seems like very open to talking to your group, which I think in hindsight ultimately ends up being the reason why she ends up being a target, right?
Who, Sydney?
Yeah.
Yes, exactly. So Sydney like very much was like, I will work with anyone, you know, like I want to flip on Luvu. And like, honestly, like Yeah, so she was very much like me, Tiffany, and Sydney had a very nice thing going on in that cycle. Where I was like thinking like, Sydney, it would be so, you know, I think it's like the thing, like, not that, it's like the Abby Maria. It's like, oh, imagine going to the end with Sydney. Like, you know what I mean? You just know that like there's going to be people that are not going to vote for her, you know? And she's also like got a, people that love her, you know? But it's just like such a controversial figure, you know? So I was like, oh man, this would be just so great. Like if that was what happened. So yeah, Sydney was down, but she also like fundamentally always was gonna, it was her, Danny and Deshaun was a three. Like, and I was like, great. I love that three. Like Deshaun, I've got like a great relationship with, let's do like, once it became clear that Liana was drifting from Yasa, I was very open to like, okay, let's do me, Tiffany, Xander, Danny, Deshaun, Sydney. And like Xander and Danny have their thing. Me and Deshaun have their thing. Me and Tiffany have a thing with Sydney. I was like, this would be great. But then that's literally like all the people that you can vote for. So yeah, that split was not ideal.
Okay. Evvie, you will go to the immunity challenge. Yes. And you'll find out, okay, that Erica turned back time and made it so the group that won the immunity challenge did not actually win the immunity challenge. And now yes. You are not going to compete for your life in the game and individual immunity.
Yes. Yes.
Did you practice the Baylor Wilson Memorial feat challenge?
I did not explicitly, but I think I told you this in my exit interview. In the Survivor quarantine, I did like all abs. So like I actually was at my peak. And that challenge, it's all abs. Like,
yeah.
And I was so close to winning, Rob. Like, so close. So, like, I was just so upset because it was like, like, what if I could have won that? But also, Ricard winning it was the worst case scenario for me. Because, like, you know, if you look at that group, you have Danny, Deshaun, Sydney, Nasir, four Lulus, and Nasir has an idol, and everybody knows it.
And Ricard could have gone in that spot if he doesn't win. Yeah.
I mean, I think that could have changed everything. Like, if I had won and he had lost, like, because, you know, he clearly would have been the odd one out. And I think that would have been really easy to make happen personally. Yeah. I mean, don't underestimate Ricard ever, but I think, you know, that
he's just coming in with very few connections.
Exactly. So that was just a horrible outcome for me.
Yeah.
Sorry. I lost my train of thought a little
bit.
Yeah. That sucked.
Yeah. So then Ricard is immune. And now all of a sudden, Evvie, you're one of what, five other people that's up for the vote.
Right. And Nasir has an idol and everyone knows it. So it's like, okay. I kind of just like eliminated him even as a, cause it's like in my head, I'm like, why the frick would you not play your idol? Like, cause I also kind of saw that Nasir was like a bit on the outside of the Luvu situation. So I don't know. It was very bad. I came back to camp extremely upset, just like thinking like this whole thing blew up in my face, you know?
So did you know that Liana has flown the coop at this point?
Yes. So first of all, like a critical thing that I think was left out of the show. So there's the whole situation where Liana has the knowledge of power. She didn't tell us. Then Shan reveals it in front of Tiffany, which clearly was like Liana had told Shan on Shipwell Island, it's the Yasa women, you know? So yes. I think Shan felt like, of course, Tiffany would know about this already. Obviously, that's like a miscalculation, but I think she just assumed, okay, well, Tiffany's Liana's ally, so Tiffany probably already knows about this advantage. Never assume on Survivor. But so anyway, Tiffany now finds out. Tiffany immediately tells me Liana has something. Then Liana, like I think the show sometimes made it seem like Liana and Tiffany were maybe closer than I was with either of them. But I really, you have to ask them, but I really don't think that was ever the case. I think I was always closer with Liana than Liana was with Tiff, and always closer with Tiff than Liana.
Can I ask one question? So did you and Tiffany just feel like that that Shan got the thing? Did you, were you under the impression that she did not come home with something?
Yes, because we had set, because remember we got to pick, because we came in first in the immunity challenge and we got to decide who goes to Shipwreck Island. And we chose Shan because Shan, you know, she's so warm. She gives it off, even just like on the mat, like at the challenges, it was like, wow, Shan is great. Let's try to work with Shan. And so we said to Liana, you know, make sure that Shan gets the advantage because we want to make sure Shan is there at the merge. So we're thinking, you know, she'll get an extra vote or whatever, and it'll guarantee that Shan makes it you know, to the merge and doesn't get voted out. Of course, Shan didn't need the advantage. So, it, you know,
Shan was already loaded.
Exactly. And she, you know, she did the exact same thing I did of being like, when I said to Deshaun, I need my vote, you take it. She Shan did the same thing to Liana. But Liana came back and said that she gave Shan whatever it was. Okay. So I did believe that. But then obviously found out that that wasn't the case. And so after Liana found out, after Tiffany found out about the advantage, Liana came to me and was like, Evvie, like, you're my number one ally. I want to like come clean to you about this and tell you about the advantage. So this is before the immunity challenge.
Yeah.
And so she tells me about the knowledge's power advantage. And we sit down and she shows me the note. And I sit with her and we read the instructions for the advantage together, which is like the most critical piece of this. Because if you see
knowledge
like,
is power.
Knowledge is power, very truly. Right. And if you see in the conversations that they showed of like me telling Xander about the advantage, I clearly have the full set of information of like,
got it.
You know, the only way to beat this is to give away the thing. But if you give away the thing, you're fine. So like that was like the very critical piece because Tiffany did not know exactly like the mechanics of it.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, so she tells me this. It was very clear. So, okay. So yeah. So just going back to, again, before the challenge, like I'm thinking, okay, it's going to be Heather or Erica. Great. But Liana is the one that right away starts of like, we got to get out Xander. And just like, Liana, like there's only three other people in this game that we like know. Like, why would we sacrifice Xander now? Like, it doesn't, you right. know, make sense. But she's, you know, she's had this bone for so long. And then I was like, I don't want to do Xander because like we still have him and Tiffany. And she said, okay, well, what if we do Tiffany? And I'm like, what the hell, Liana? Like yeah. we have like, you know, like there's 12 people left in this game. And like, why would we get rid of Yasa people now? So it was very, very clear like where she was going. And, you know, I didn't, what's annoying is like, if I had known that I was vulnerable, I would have just been yesing all these plans. You know what I mean? Like you don't put your foot down when you think that you're at risk. I'd be like, fuck yeah, like let's get rid of Xander. Like, I don't care. You mm-hmm. know what I mean? It's like I felt like I was safe. So I wanted the plan to happen that I actually wanted to happen instead of, you know, just anything but me, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it was very clear that she was shifting more and more towards Shan. And I felt like there was an option for me to go with them. Like but then I was thinking, you know, if it's Liana, Shan, Ricard, and me. I don't feel that good about Ricard. I feel like great about Liana, but she's clearly closer with Shan. It's like, I'm the bottom of that group of people. Like, I don't want to go in that direction. Again, this is all coming from the perspective of like thinking I had power that I didn't have. Because I would have gone along with anything if I had known how vulnerable I was.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, so that was all becoming more and more clear. And then obviously when it all flips and it's like, you can only vote for these people. I knew that I was clearly going to be the majority target.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So could you just work through exactly, okay, how does this plan come together? That is how did you know that Liana was going to use the knowledge's power at that particular moment? Or were you prepared in a contingency that she wasn't going to use it?
I mean, I just felt like, of course she's going to. Like, she has been trying to screw Xander the entire game. You know, like, since day five, this has been her thing of, like, I want to make Xander look dumb. You know what I mean? Like, it just was so, so tantalizing for her to do that. And so what happened was we came back to camp, and Xander instantly is telling people, I'm playing my idol for Evvie, which was, I mean, amazing. And I, like, genuinely was crying from, like, gratitude at that, like, that he would, you know, whether or not he plays it, that he's going to even say that, like, is very, very good for me. But then, of course, when he's going around saying, I'm going to play my idol, very clearly the person with the idol stealing power is going to be like, ha, 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 Xander thinks right. that, you know, so it's just like so obvious that that would be the chain of thought. If Xander's going to say, I'm going to play my idol, Liana's going to say, well, I'm going to steal your idol so you can't play your idol.
But how much intention is behind that? Is he saying that because he knows that that there's somebody who's going to try to steal the idol?
I don't think so. I don't think at first. I think he was genuinely trying to. I think he was trying to get the target off me. Of like, there's no point in targeting Evvie because I'm going to play my idol for Evvie. So I think it was a more baseline plan.
Got it.
Then we're sitting there, and I'm like, okay, well, fuck. Clearly Liana is going to try to steal it because Xander's telling everyone that he's going to play it for me. And very instantly I like look at Tiffany and Xander. And we're like, we got to move the idol. And again, this is all coming from the fact that Liana let me see the note, which like, and it's one of those things where it's like, I feel like a lot of people watching the episode were like, how could Liana think that they're not going to move it? You know, like kind of thinking that Liana is being dumb or something. But I think the thing is like, you have to remember how close me and Liana were, that I'm sure she thought that it would be inconceivable to me that she would betray me like that intensely, you know? Like, we were number one allies from the beginning of the game. So like, it was like, oh my God, this is so over the top that she's gonna like use this extremely strong advantage to steal an idol that would just save me. When it's like, you don't have to, if she didn't have to do that, you know what I mean? Like, they could have just either let me go home, you know what I mean? Like, it just was not necessary. But it just was very obvious to me, knowing Liana, that that is what was gonna happen. But I get why she would think that I wouldn't think that she would do that. You know what I mean? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So okay. Anyway, we go into the woods and are doing this like idol maneuver. And it was literally like, Survivor is not scripted, but this moment was so fucking, like, it could have been scripted. It was so good. Cause like, me, Tiffany, and Xander were sitting there. Xander gives Tiffany the real idol. She shoves it in her bra. He takes out the fake idol. Tiffany runs away. And like, that second that Xander's standing there holding the fake idol, Liana walks in. Like, it's just so perfect. Cause obviously she thought she walked in on him holding the real idol, but it just like was the exact right second of him holding the fake idol. Yeah. And so, you know, Liana is very much trying to be like, okay, we're good. Like, you're going to play the idol. Like, it'll be fine. And I think the other thing is like, for another probably like hour, we were sitting around of me being like, pretending to Liana that I'm just so scared about whether Xander's going to play the idol for me. And she's like, quote unquote, comforting me. And it just was like so over the top. And that's why like in Tribal, I got like a little heated with her of the like, thanks Liana. Cause it was just like, really? Like, you're going to sit there and like rub my back and like do deep breathing exercises with me when you're like planning this like ultimate betrayal. But you know, if it had worked, it would have been a badass move, but you know, saw it coming.
Yeah. Okay. And then so Tiffany has the real idol. Did you talk through any contingencies about what ultimately did end up happening where, okay, now should Tiffany play the idol under any circumstances?
Well, yes. And I said, no matter what, you have to play the idol for me. Because obviously that's what I want to have. And it's just like, I will say, I did not think that, I assumed that Tiffany's loyalty to me was such that she would play the idol for me no matter what. Yeah. I didn't anticipate that. I kind of knew, like, obviously Xander doesn't want to play the idol. Like, obviously it's much better for him to end up with the idol still. But like, I thought that Tiffany would listen to me and play it no matter what. But I think she viewed that as just like, I can't play Xander's idol if he doesn't want me to, which I, you know, I understand, but like, I very much was like, no matter what, play the idol. Cause we don't know what they're going to do.
Evvie, how much, did it impact you that, really of the potential, like, choices to be voted for, you end up on Deshaun, who's this person that you ended up having a pretty good relationship, right, coming into the merge. And now it sort of like, really ends up straining that relationship in the short term.
Right. Honestly, this is the thing that I like think about the most of, should we have tried to put the target on someone else in this cycle?
What about Danny?
I mean, Danny was kind of a no-go because everyone loves Danny. Like, he just really is.
Well, are you out of people then? I mean, what are you going to do, Nasir?
Sydney was the person.
Sydney.
Like, and it ended up freaking being Sydney. But like, the annoying thing is that Sydney was the one that seemed to want to work with me and Tiffany the most. So I was like, I really want to keep Sydney. But that was, I think, greedy. Because the thing is, I knew that Heather hated Sydney. Like, that would have been easy to get. Like it just seemed like maybe we could have gotten more people on it. But fundamentally, Danny was very attached to Sydney. So if Danny wasn't going to vote for Sydney, then Deshaun probably wasn't going to vote for Sydney. So I think we were stuck. I think we were stuck. But I do think, like, if it hadn't been the target on Deshaun, maybe he wouldn't have truth bombed me. Maybe he wouldn't have. I also just really didn't like, when I met Deshaun, I was like, this guy is like me. Like, we both are like, love the game, playing the game hard. Like,
doctors. So,
doctors, both of us, like, you know, not yet doctors. Mm-hmm. I thought that he, like me, wouldn't really take things personally in the game. Like, you know what I mean? Like, even if Liana had betrayed me, like, I mean, she did betray me like that. And I'm still like, I mean, I love Liana. Like, you know what I mean? It's a game. Like, she's, so I didn't anticipate how much Deshaun would hold it against us that we voted for him. You know, which, which of course makes sense. Like, I get it. I just thought that, like, it was so clear. It's like, Deshaun, I never wanted this situation to occur. This was just like the completely artificial situation of this twist. Not to mention, it's like, it was just like frustrating to watch back his confessionals of like, Yasa is like scrim. It's like, everybody in the game voted for me. Like, you know, or like was part of the, like, I don't have the luxury to be mad at anyone. So it's like frustrating for him to be like, these three people, blah, 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 you know what I mean? But like, you know, I love Deshaun. I love Deshaun. But like, so anyway, I do wonder what would have happened if we had just gone for Sydney. But I, ultimately, I thought Sydney was someone that would work with us. So I like didn't want to lose her. But
Okay. So the whole thing ends up happening. Can you have the Xander? Can I have your idol? You go, no, you have this fake one.
So good.
Yeah. It's so a big, big moment. I guess was that right before that was going back to you. You mentioned Deshaun's truth bomb. You got the first truth bomb.
I know. And honestly, I think it was so lucky that like right after he said that, Liana jumped in with doing the thing because it kind of like distracted from that. With like, yeah, no, that sucked. I mean, I kind of thought he was gonna do it. To be like, it was just like, okay, obviously he knows I'm coming for him. He's got this information, which is why I was so happy that Tiffany had the idol also. Because I'm like, this idol is saving me. It's great for the person that's about to feel really betrayed by me, Xander, to not have it. But I mean, I do think what Deshaun with his truth bombs, I mean, the way better move would have been to go to Xander before Tribal.
Right.
And say, Evvie's not with, you know, not with you. Like, that's the move.
The Tribal truth bomb rarely works.
Right. I mean, no one wants to change their vote at Tribal. Like, you know, I mean, and the other thing, it's also hard because Xander also like needed me and Tiffany, right? Because if he wasn't with us, Liana would have stolen his idol. So it's like, it just feel like it wasn't the optimal use of he had. And the other thing is he only told, to my knowledge, he only told Xander, Evvie told me you have the idol. He didn't say, Evvie told me you were going to be voted out. Like, that's honestly, I feel like the much worse thing. Like, you were at the bottom of Yasa and you didn't know it. Like,
now, did the truth bomb impact Xander as far as you know in any way?
I mean, I don't know. I really think you have to ask Xander. This is something that I feel like I've never gotten. I don't know the answer, truthfully. I mean, I think he never really wanted to play the idol. Obviously, he wanted to keep the idol. I think he genuinely thought I wasn't going to go home when he said, don't play the idol. But he also, like, wanted to keep the idol. I mean, I think the biggest impact of the truth bomb, obviously, it, to some degree, I'm sure, shook his trust in me. I mean, no, it did. It definitely did shake his trust in me. But I think the bigger thing is he also used it as a way to say to everybody else in the game, I'm not with Yasa anymore because you saw what Evvie did to me. Like, he felt like his strategy was to distance himself from Yasa, and the truth bomb like made it believable. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But I also think he was like worried, you know, about me.
Mm-hmm. So, at any point, did you give Xander a heads up and say just you know, I told Xander some thing or told Deshaun some things, but like it wasn't true.
Right. No, I didn't. I mean, I told Liana and Tiffany. Mm-hmm. Right after, like after that day, you know, after the tribal were voting to go home, I told them the next day, I was like, listen, we've got a problem. But I didn't tell Xander because, you know, with Xander, it's like, all I was focused on was getting the idol to Tiffany. You know what I mean? Like, there's not that much time to like get this plan to happen. And I don't want to fuck it up by being like, by the way, you know what I mean? So it's like the tribal truth at tribal is the place where you're least likely to like come up with an alternate plan. So I was like, if it happens, it happens. But at least like the idols with Tiffany, like, you know, we're just going to have to go from there.
Okay. Things become.
What do you think? Do you think I should have told? I mean, I just don't think it would have been better to tell him earlier.
I don't know. It really depends on how much did it change what he ultimately wanted to do. You know, I feel like that week Shannon had like a really great podcast about this whole situation with George from Australian Survivor. And they were going through like all of the different scenarios of what you need to do. But I think there was some thought that maybe that Xander didn't play the idol because the truth bomb had like changed his thinking.
Right. But if that's true, would telling him 2 hours beforehand mm-hmm. have made it, you know what I mean? I just don't think that would have helped, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, maybe, but I just think that the thing is, the act of telling Deshaun was the problem. So I just don't think the, when I told Xander about it was gonna solve the situation. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I personally.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
It's difficult, you know, these sort of like damage control, like situations, like is the act of like telling him potentially going to be something that's going to put a seed of doubt in his mind?
Right. Right. And that's what I think. I mean, I would rather him go guns blazing into that tribal with this vision in his mind of like, we're going to do this thing and we're going to like, we've always been together and we're going to like pull one over on Liana and like do this epic move. And that is what, like, he was going into it so psyched about that whole situation.
Yeah.
So it's like, I don't want to do anything to mess up that. Like, that's the most important piece of this.
Yeah.
And there's nothing he can do about that except beg Tiffany not to play it. And I miscalculated that I could convince Tiffany to play it no matter what. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
So the tribal council is live and everything is going on. Did the vote almost go in any other different directions when everybody is scrambling?
Well, yes. So, I mean, so they were trying to tell us that they were voting for Nasir, the other side. Because I think there's a lot of questions like, why did we put our votes on Deshaun? And it was just like, very confusing of what they were doing. Like, if we knew that they were splitting definitely on me and Sydney, obviously the three of us would have just voted for Sydney. But it was very confusing of what are they actually doing? And it's hard for me because like, I feel like I could have figured it out, but I'm the one that they're going to tell the least. Do you know what I mean? Because I'm obviously the target. And something that I know that Danny mentioned in his exit interviews is that Nasir actually saved me because he was supposed to vote for me and he voted for Sydney because him and Sydney had this mm-hmm. bad relationship and me and Nasir liked each other. So like that social game like really did like come into play there. But you saw like we were really trying to get Nasir to vote with us. So and ultimately he did like, you know, he didn't vote with us, but he did enough to say, I mean, he saved me. So, mm-hmm. Him and obviously Sydney playing the shot in the dark.
Yeah. How surprised were you when Sydney plays the shot in the dark?
Oh my gosh. No, I knew she was going to, cause she was looking at me like the two of us knew it felt like, you know, she was kind of sitting there, right? Like she was kind of like resigned on this situation to some degree. And she was like, should I play the shot in the dark? And I was honestly like, yeah, honestly, I wish I had had the next level of like, great. Cause then I was just like, yeah, it seems like you're at risk. Play your shot, you know, whatever. Like I was hoping that me and Sydney could both survive it. So I wasn't surprised, but I was so fucking relieved that it was not safe, obviously. I mean, I was picked as they're reading the votes. I'm like this, like I literally am like picking up my bag. Like clearly it's going to be me. So such a relief.
Because it's five votes for Sydney. What? And then four votes for you.
Yep. And then three Deshaun.
And three for Deshaun. So but she would have voted for Deshaun, right?
I think she would have voted for me. I mean, I think that was part of.
Her problem. Sounds right. That sounds right.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it was also part of her problem is that like she did want to work with us and she did want to work with them. So that kind of also left her of like, I don't know what to do to some degree. But she should have voted for me, obviously.
Right. And then just instead, she does the shot in the dark and ultimately she ends up going home. Okay. So after this, and then Xander doesn't play the idol on you, but we were all feeling like in the real time of it, like, boy, watch out now for this Yasa 3 because they just pulled off this big move and they saved Evvie. And here we go, the ultimate underdogs, but that was not how it played out.
I know. And I really felt the same way as everyone watching at home. Like I was like, obviously this truth bomb thing happened or whatever, but it's like, we just freaking pulled this thing off. Like, and we come back from camp and the three of us are like hugging each other, like so happy. Like we just like did this thing. But obviously I do think this is where the truth bomb impact probably was the most of Xander being like, did I just save someone that isn't actually loyal to me, even though no freaking skin off his back. He didn't lose his idol. Like, and I think honestly, like, I feel I felt like when Xander then ditched us, it's like, I deserve that. You know what I mean? Like, I wish that's not what happened, but of course I contributed to that situation. I can't really blame him. But like Tiffany, it really, really burned her up because she gave him his idol back. She didn't play the idol for me. You know what I mean? Like, she was like fully loyal to him. And like, he just kind of, Yeah, and it's just frustrating because I felt like me, Tiffany, and Xander, that's three. There's 11 people left in the game, right? So the magic number is six. So me, Tiffany, Xander is three. He has an extra vote. He has an idol. And there's clearly people, like, the thing about the whole other group of, like, that mega alliance, it's like they weren't an alliance. They were the people that worked together on this one vote that was crazy chaotic. Like, it was so obvious that, like, Erica and Heather and Nasir were not really part of that alliance in the same way. And if we had been a three, it would have been so easy to pull them over. But because we were a nothing, then mm-hmm. It's like there's nowhere for them to go.
Yeah.
And that's actually something, sorry to like Erica. So obviously when Erica came back from exile, everyone was pitching to her, right? Like, vote with us. And emotionally, I mean, we told her, Deshaun is throwing you under the bus like crazy. They like have been, you know, targeting you all day. Come with us. And it was very clear to me, like, emotionally, she did want to come with us. But logically, she's like, well, who is the group? And we don't have the majority, mm-hmm. You know? And to me, Erica not making that move, I thought was really, really smart. You know what I mean? Yeah. Why would you switch to be the bottom of the minority instead of the bottom of the majority? But also, like, I think a lot of people emotionally would just be like, what? Deshaun's coming after me? I'm going to, you know, so that's where I started to think like Erica's really good because like that was a very smart move to not make that move, you know?
You know, we didn't really see you have a lot of interaction with Erica either right. In the season. Obviously, she's a super important part of the season. Did you have any sort of relationship with her?
Yeah. So we had a really good talk when she came back from exile of, you know, to the Yas people just like pitching her so hard. But obviously she made the decision to go with the numbers. The next day, she and I had like a really nice, like get to know you conversation. I really liked her and thought that she was smart and similar to me in a lot of ways, but it just was like, how are we going to get this done? And then, you know, we can talk a little more like as these cycles continue, like she was very clearly like gonna make a move. It was just a question of when. So I definitely felt like this is a smart person that's playing the game. And like, I said this in some of my things, like I wanted to do what she did of hide for a long time and then, you know, come into your own at the right time. I just like, both that's not really my personality, I realized. And also like, I didn't have that situation with Yasa going to travel so much. But so I definitely like, I had overall a good feeling about her, but just not like, we never worked together ultimately.
Do you feel like that, like in another reality, maybe turn back time, where, you know, you were playing in a season where it was like a 9-player tribe, that do you feel like that the Erica's game could have been your game?
Yeah, I mean, that's really what I wanted my game to be. Like, if you look at my pregame stuff, everything I'm saying, it's like, I want to, like, be underestimated and under the radar, and I want to, like, have a pair, and I want to, like you know, come into my own later. Like, that is exactly what I wanted to do. So, you know, I think maybe it could. I also do think, I read an interview once with Zeke, where he said something like, that he just wants to shine all the time. And it's like really hard to win Survivor when you want to shine like that. Like, and I do think that's me to some degree. You know, you're there and you're like, this is my one chance to like be on Survivor. Like, what yeah. if I just get out and never did anything, you know? So it's like, ultimately, I think I chose the path of, I would rather like be a big character who's like playing really hard, even if that means I lose, rather than take the risk of never doing anything. But maybe that's ultimately like the winning game. You know?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. I totally get that. So,
yeah.
All right. We now have where, okay, Xander doesn't want to work with right. and with you and Tiffany, and you're at the bottom.
Right. And to be clear, it's like, it was so weird because it was like that night we come back, everything's good. We wake up in the morning and I'm not even kidding. Like Xander never talked to me again, basically. Mm-hmm. Like, and it wasn't like, hey, let's separate. You know what I mean? Like, I think at one point, you know, he mouthed to me like, separate after like 7 hours of him not talking to me. So it was like, is this a plan or are you actually mad at me? Or is it, but like, it just, I never knew like really where I stood with him from then on. So, I mean, that day sucked. Like, mm-hmm. you know, everyone, it was very clear that I was on the outs, but I also like did have good personal relationships with everyone. Like
yeah.
Shane and I had a good personal relationship with Sean and I. So I was really just focusing in that time of like, let's get these personal relationships back as much as possible and then try to like navigate the game from there.
Yeah. Well, this is really your episode where that you know, you have a great scene where you're talking about sort of like from a sociological perspective, you are really feeling that you are at the bottom of this pecking order where you are you can't even like the group won't even like really acknowledge you.
Yes. And I think what's something that's interesting is I think a lot of people watching at home, like especially because Xander's the one that like ultimately like makes the flashy move of the like, no, have this fake, you know. You think that Xander would be the number one target. But I think, and I think in a lot of other seasons with a different cast, you know, he's the really athletic. He just like was part of this big move. Like he would have been the number one target. But I really think like something about our cast and like the type of jury that then votes for Erica all to win. Like we really were, I feel like people valued like a different, people really put an emphasis on the social game and like the strategic game. And I think that's why I was seen as like
the mastermind of that.
Right. Right. And like when you have someone like Shan in charge, like Shan sees me for someone who's kind of like her in what I'm doing, you know? So, and she also later is going to be someone who's like targeting Erica, you know? Like I just, it's just interesting of like who you view as a threat as it relates to your own gameplay, I think. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And then also I wonder if like Xander has like some sort of like first mover advantage of being like the first one to basically like try to throw your group under the bus where it's like, okay, well, like, and you know, he has a decent relationship with Danny and people feel like, okay, okay, he'll vote with us. Let's go after the person who's, you know, really behind, these capers.
Exactly. Absolutely. Absolutely. And I also think like, it's so interesting to me. I don't know what would have happened if Heather hadn't blown up that tribal council. Like, would they have just split it on Tiffany and Xander goes home? Like, I really, we'll never know, you know? Yeah. Anyway, I'm on the outside. No one will talk to me. It sucks.
Yes. But, okay, we're going to have the reward challenge and we draw the rocks again. And it's going to play for some grilled cheese.
Grilled cheese.
And so Erica again draws the rock that she ends up getting sit out. She says, can't believe her luck. And then Xander is going to switch spots with her and be like, oh, Xander, he sees a secret advantage.
Right.
But oh, yeah.
You know, I did not know. I don't think any of us knew that that secret advantage was there until we're watching the episode. You know, because he never, so that was honestly freaking crazy to me that that advantage was there.
Right. In hindsight, I mean, the one that Sarah Lucina finds was like this giant tube of like roll of paper towels down there.
Right. Of, that says secret advantage. On it. Yeah.
I mean, when Xander, what is he going to like turn the thing over and inspect it with like a fine tooth comb to find that thing?
Right. And I think like what he said in his confessional of like, he wants to be with the losers is honestly like, that is smart and like makes sense. But like in the, what everyone is seeing is like, it just, it did feel that very like performative, like the speech of I'm gonna, you know, for Erica, blah, blah. And I think that's part of something that like ultimately like took away from Xander's game is that I think he was making really smart decisions a lot of the time, but his like frontal explanations were so eye-rolly. Even though like the move was maybe smart, but it's just like when you have so long of like the eye roll feeling, it's hard to like reverse that. You know what I mean?
Right. Right. Yeah. Okay. So here you go. Tell me your group is trailing and then you come in and then put the puzzles together. Do you tell them like, hey, listen, I got this.
Yes. I was freaking out. Like, cause remember also it's like, I'm at my lowest point in the game. Like I really just almost went home. Like everything to me is like, I had the attitude of like, everything is icing on the cake at this point. Like I should have gone home and not even made the jury. And like, I'm still here. So like, fuck it. You know what I mean? And as we're like pulling up to the challenge, I see it. And I'm like, this is the one. I know this. Like I literally just looking at the setup. I was like, I have this. I told everyone in my team, like I got this puzzle. I promise. And I know that a lot of people were like, Evvie should have like, you know, it was too much how quickly I did it and everything. When you're in the moment, like I didn't realize how fast it was relative to the other group. Cause like you said, we were trailing. My whole thing, I'm just trying to win and like catch up. And I don't know how, I'm not looking at them to see that they haven't made like any progress. I'm just like, go, try to, and like finish it. And so like, I didn't know how fast I did it until everyone was freaking out. You know what I mean? So whatever it was, I mean, I don't regret it at all. Like it was an awesome moment, but yeah. Yeah.
Big moment. Jeff seems very pleased. Like, did you get a sense? Like, does the challenge producers, like the dream team, give you a side eye or anything like that?
Well, no, but like after the game, like one of the producers said to me, like, I thought that something broke in the challenge. Like, cause it just like so quick. But no, Jeff, I mean, loved it. Like, and that's, I mean, honestly, that's the thing that screwed me is how much Jeff loved it and mm-hmm. being like, that was a future Survivor. It's like, no,
pay attention.
Yeah, like, shut up. Mm-hmm. But I mean, also, it's sick. Like, you know what I mean? Like, it's like, you have to, this is the thing. I like to sparkle. Like, it was sick.
It's the dream, you know, as a viewer to be able to, like, you think about, like, oh, okay, I'm going to, like, I'm going to do exactly what you did. You know, right. I feel like that as a viewer, it's like, wait, what the hell was that?
Right. I mean, and it's also, like, it was so annoying because, like I said, I was bad at puzzles. Like, mm-hmm. I lost all the Yasa puzzles. And now it's like, now I can't shake this thing of, like, suddenly I'm good at puzzles. And it's like, I just knew this one puzzle, you know?
Yeah. Okay. So you get grilled cheese for the group. And now, look at you, two meals in a row.
I know. Well, that's the thing. And then I eat the stew. So, like, I'm well mm-hmm. fed.
Okay.
Well, so what I'm trying to do also is, like, okay, I know that it's very clear that Danny's thing is like, I'm the biggest guy out here and I don't want people to see me as a threat. So I'm like trying to pitch to him, like, clearly I'm a big challenge threat now, right? Like, I just won this puzzle and like we're the same, but he never saw it that way. Like, Danny always was like only thinking, like, he viewed himself as distinct from the puzzle threats. It was like the physical threats and the puzzle threats. So I'm just like trying everything. I'm like trying that with him. I'm really trying to get Deshaun back, which ultimately I think I do to some degree. Mm-hmm. I'm trying everything, you know, but it's clearly didn't actually work in this cycle.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. A lot of talking, a lot of plans going on, a lot of names getting thrown out. Did you feel like you were starting to get traction anywhere?
Not really, honestly. Like, I knew, like, I wasn't really, because, well, I mean, before the immunity challenge, I no one was talking strategy with me. So I was like, okay, it's obviously me, like, or, you know, someone else. I mean, I was trying, but it's just like, I was definitely getting stonewalled. But it also, the interesting thing is, it felt like there was a lot of general frustration, because you have this mm-hmm. like mega alliance that really, it seemed like Shan was dictating the vote to, like, especially like Shan and Liana. And then you have like Deshaun's getting a little irritated, Heather ultimately is going to get irritated, Nasir is going to get irritated. Like, there were, like, it's just too many people, you know what I mean? And like, so it felt like this group is not going well, but like not fast enough for me to be safe in this round. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And like, it's going to come apart at the seams. Like, it's untenable at this point, but exactly. You know, that you are like a big enough target to like keep this group united for, you know, at least like another round.
Right. Well, and that's why I was so like, I just need to get through this vote. Cause it's just like, this group is not going to last, you know? And that's why it just killed me that then I did make it through that vote, but then we have the freaking split tribal thing, which just like left me so exposed, because I do think if it had been that full group, it might've fallen. I mean, it fell apart the very next vote after that, where Shan goes home. Mm-hmm. So it's just like, it was that close, you know?
Now, are you considering throwing Xander under the bus to this point of like, oh, why are you worried about me? We should go through Xander.
Oh yeah, of course. And I said to Deshaun, you know, like, of course I would vote for Xander. And he's like, really? I thought you guys were so tight. And I was like, he didn't play the idol on me. Like, yeah. I made that speech a little bit at the tribal council. Like, I really tried to emphasize that of like, I don't feel loyalty to Xander anymore. Like, it's like, I would have if he had stayed with me, but he's not talking to me and he didn't play the idol for me. Like, he would have let me go home. And that's completely his prerogative. But I certainly don't feel like, oh, I could never vote for Xander. Like, of course not.
Yeah. And what about going back to Liana? Like, hey, Liana, you know, I like what you said about voting out Xander all those times.
Yeah. And of course I tried that, you know, and I think they showed like that night after the tribal, like the one where Sydney went home, Liana and I had a conversation of like, on a human level, we're totally good. Like, you know, but it's just, the momentum was too strong in this one cycle to get it off me. But mm-hmm. it was so annoying because like they did kind of like take Xander a little bit. And again, it seemed like they were going to split the votes on him. So I don't know how much that actually worked versus like Heather fucked up their plan. But I cannot tell you how mad it made me and Tiff to watch Liana and Xander now be like working together. It's like, Are you freaking kidding me? Like, Liana blew up Yasa because she wanted to get Xander out so badly. And now he's the one that she's going to work with?
Mm-hmm.
That was annoying. But, like, you know, it is what it is.
So we have the immunity challenge where Jeff is going to ask people, all right, we need some people to sit out. If you sit out, then I'll, you know, give some rice for the group. Give some rations. Okay.
Yes.
How many people... so we have the whole negotiation there. You have to feel like, okay, let's get some more people sitting out of this challenge.
Oh my God. Of course. I was so happy. I couldn't believe my luck that it was going to be a one where some people were going to not do the challenge. Cause like, obviously I needed this so bad. And I don't know if you guys, I felt like Shan was really trying to get me to sit out. And I'm like, I'm not going to fucking sit out. Like, of course not. Like, I know I need this, but like, she was like making she has the pull, like she's making direct eye contact with me, like, come on, like for the group. We're like, everybody that sat out, the first three people, Shan, Nasir, Xander, all had idols. Like, it's not noble. Like, you guys are fine. Like, yes. Anyway, I was happy.
You were happy. Now, this was the block on your head challenge.
Did you
practice this one?
Again, not explicitly. I just was in general like working out. But calf raises is something that is always has been part of my routine sometimes. So I felt, I didn't think I was going to win it. I thought Liana was good. That felt like a kind of challenge Liana could win. That was sick. Going back to like way in the pregame, just because it relates to this, and I don't know if this is, I feel like it's okay. So in the pregame, we're at the like pre-area and there's all these books and I've already used up all my books because we've been in like 2 weeks of quarantine, right? And I look flicking through the books and you know that book Wild about the woman that like hikes the Pacific Trail? They made a movie with Reese Witherspoon. Anyway, sorry, I know this feels like a tangent, but it's good.
You're good.
Okay, so I'm like, oh, maybe I'll read this book. I don't know. And I'm like flipping through it. And in the front cover is written in pen, read this book. Okay, wait, I have it written down because it was so sick. This is from my notes in the thing. It says, read this. I love this book and you will too. Ask yourself, who is tougher than me? Answer, no one. Now go kick some ass. Luck and love, Little Debbie, season 31.
Debbie Wanner?
Debbie Wanner. So this is a note that she wrote in the pregame of what she thought was season 31, but then was actually season 32.
Now, hold on a second.
Yeah.
Are we sure that this wasn't in the pregame of season 34?
It says season 31. She wrote season 31.
Okay. Because she then is going to play in season 32. Right, yes. Because
remember, they thought it was 31.
Yes. But that was in Cambodia. They packed up all the books and brought them to Fiji?
I think so. I think there's just like pregame books.
Survivor Library. Yes.
Yes. Survivor Library.
Okay, read that inscription for us one more time.
Okay. Read this. I loved it and believe you will too. Ask yourself, who is tougher than me? Answer, no one. Smiley face. Now go kick ass. Luck and love, Little Debbie, S31.
Never heard her referred to as Little Debbie.
Little Debbie, I know.
The snack cake.
I was also so confused because I was like, season 31? Like, there wasn't a Debbie. And then I was like, yes.
Evvie, you were reading from a book. I presume that was not, you didn't steal the book from Fiji. You journaled your time at Ponderosa?
Yes. This was my pregame and postgame journal. Where I wrote notes to myself. Yeah. I wrote tons of notes and they're all like addressed in the form of like letters to my girlfriend, but they're really just journals.
Wow.
Yes. So I bring this up because that thing, the like, ask yourself who's tougher than you, answer no one. That stuck with me. Like, I really thank Little Debbie because, like, literally when I'm doing that challenge, I'm thinking that, like, no one's tougher than me. Debbie told me no one's tougher than me, and I'm going to keep this block on my freaking head as long as I can. And, so anyway, I watched my note because I just, like, it was a really cool, like, message from the Survivor past that really did stick with me through a lot of the game. And I actually went back when those books were still there in Ponderosa, and I wrote like cosign Evvie season 41.
Wow.
So I wonder if someone from 42 found that.
What a treat that will be for some Survivor 43 contestant or Survivor 44 contestants listening to this when they get to Fiji to be able to check the book out of the library.
Right.
And then see Boy, this is like, you know, Survivor High School. It's like, oh, my dad had this textbook of right? What? Wow.
There was also in there was another book there that Stephanie Valencia is that or no not Stephanie Valencia, Stephanie Gonzalez, the okay. first out in Ghost Island.
Yes, Gonzalez.
There was a little note in one of them too, but I wasn't sure how much to take her advice, you know.
Okay, was it a positive affirmation? I mean, she might have been probably post game.
I think it was the book was Water for Elephants, and she wrote like, read this book, don't read leadership books.
Oh, then maybe it's post game. Yeah.
Yeah, it was a post game.
Yeah, wow. I love this idea of the Survivor right? Library.
Right? It's cool. So, yeah, future players.
Look Did you leave any notes in any other books?
No, I think it was just that one. Yeah.
If you play again, will you bring a book and leave it there?
Ooh, that's a wonderful idea. I love that. Although, now that I've said this, do you think the Ponderosa people are going to be onto it and like, remove all the books?
Why would they? Why?
Right, it's just like, fun.
Yeah. This is like a, you know, the Survivor Museum.
Right? It was really, really cool to think like, Debbie wrote this note and now I have it. And like, I'm going to take
this. Did you check all the other books for notes?
Well, so after that one, I found this other one with the note from Stephanie. I'm sure there's more. Like look clear wow. with future people.
Yeah. Okay, there's all sorts of gems that are in the library.
Right? It was, like you said, it's the textbook thing of like, wow, like that senior had this book, but yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. All right, so that you Little Debbie inspired you.
Right.
You won immunity, and yes. then were you trying to get something going now that you felt like, okay, now I'm safe?
Right. So honestly, I was just like, I want people to forget about me. My only like way to survive long in this game, like I'm not going to be able to, if I try to be out in front in any way, it's just going to like alert people to me more and more. Mm-hmm. So I was really just like, I want to be as invisible as possible this round, you know? And so I was trying to just like keep it low key. I was like hanging out at camp. I was like, I want everyone to just see me. Cause also like everyone kept being like, they didn't believe that Yasa was broken up, you know, like, because it was so weird. Like literally like that night we're hugging. And then the next day we're not talking to each other, you know? And so Danny kept being like, come on, Evvie, what's the secret plan? Like, what's the secret plan? I'm like, I don't have a plan. I'm just sitting here. Like, so I was just really trying to be like, don't mind me. I'm just sitting here. But at one point there was like 1 second where Xander like asked me, do you think it's me? And I was like, I honestly have no idea, but if it were me, if I was them, I would split it between you and Tiff. Like that just is what mm-hmm. So that was, and then also I was working on Deshaun of just like, I feel like once it was obvious that I was going to still be there, people were a little bit thinking, what can I do with Evvie going forward?
Right.
And so Deshaun, I think I told you this in my exit interview, like Deshaun was the only one in that round that was like, Evvie, like after today, let's work together. And so I was like, great. So after this vote, the next day, a lot of people were coming to me. And like that night, a lot of people were coming to me. But Deshaun, he got in there first. So like I did still have this like warm feeling for Deshaun that screwed me over and over again.
But, yeah, it's so hard because I think the people like know that what you're capable of. Right. And it's sort of like, okay, well, Evvie's down and out. But you're not the type of person that people are going to drag along as a number.
Right. That's the thing. And it's like, I was hoping, I was like, what, me? But it's like, they saw me, you know what I mean? Like they already, it was there. But I do think people were considering it. I really, really, really to my bones don't think that if it hadn't been the split tribal, I don't think I was going home that round.
All right, well, we'll talk about that in a minute. Let's talk about, okay, so the live tribal, you mentioned it a couple times, so that it looks like it's going to be a split vote between Xander and Tiffany, but yeah. Heather stands up.
Right.
And then all hell breaks loose.
All hell breaks loose. I mean, okay, so, I mean, you have to, I don't know if you asked Heather about this in your exit interview or anything. I didn't hear it. But
I did, yes.
Okay, here's what I always thought this is what she said to me after that. What she said is that she was nervous because Tiffany was raring to go as well to like live tribal it up because Tiffany obviously knew that she was at risk. So Tiffany's plan was to try to talk to Xander into using the extra vote or something. And then maybe like we would get to vote. Like maybe Yas would vote together with the extra vote. Like she wanted to talk to Xander because Xander wouldn't talk to her all day. So she was like, hoping that she could make something happen at Tribal. Heather was sitting next to Tiffany and Heather like perceived that Tiffany was trying to do something. And Heather was nervous that Tiffany would mess up the big group plan. And so that's why Heather got up and was like what Heather, what she said to me is that she was trying to trick me and Heather, me and Tiffany into like voting for Nasir to make sure that whatever we were trying to do wouldn't happen. So it's like in what Heather told me is that she was trying to stick with the plan by making it seem like she wasn't sticking with the plan.
No, I don't think that that was exactly what that sounds new. I feel like she said that she was trying to get the vote onto Nasir.
So she was actually trying to get the vote into Nasir.
I think so.
Well, that's what she said to me was vote Nasir. So like, yeah. So, I mean, I guess that makes sense also to make it her, not the decoy vote.
Yeah.
But of course she just made it worse for herself. Ultimately.
Yeah. And then, Shan and Liana are then saying like, oh, well, maybe we should just vote for Heather here in this spot. And then ultimately Deshaun doesn't like that.
Right. Which all of this was so good for me. I mean, it sucked obviously that Tiffany did go home, but like Tiff before Tribal had said to me, vote Heather. And I literally had no idea what the big group like actual plan was. I was like, I think they're going to split it. Tiff Xander, like, I don't really know. Probably Xander will play his idol. I don't want to piss anyone off. I think voting for Heather won't piss anyone off, you know, like, except for Heather, obviously. But then when Shan pulls me into the big group and says, Evvie, are you down? Let's vote Heather. I'm like, hell yeah, because I already was going to vote Heather. And now the next day I get to turn around and be like, Shan, you told me to vote Heather and I voted Heather. Like, you can trust me. You know, so it was like, this works for me. You know, it didn't really, but it was better than anything else.
Okay. So ultimately Tiffany is going to go home. And so you are back at the final 10, right? And but you're feeling good. Things are looking up.
Right. Right, because there was this huge fight at Tribal. Like, Shan and Deshaun are, like, shouting at each other coming back to camp and are very, very frustrated. And then also, I do feel like it sucks that Tiffany went home, but people were so scared of the, like, Yasa 3. Now Tiffany's gone, so there's only two of us, and Xander, everyone has seen now that we weren't up to something. So, like, maybe I am just a one person, which I really felt like I was, you know? Deshaun is saying, like, I want a new group. I'm going to work with you, Evvie. Shan and Liana, like the next morning, like pull me aside in a very like mafia pastor style format of like Evvie, sit with us. What are you thinking? Like very like I felt like, you know, I was being brought to the boss.
And what were you thinking? What did you tell Shan?
I said to Shan and Liana, like I wouldn't go to the end with Danny or Deshaun. Like I mean, from their perspective, like, I was like, they're both great. Like, I don't want to go to the end with a guy who just had a baby, who everyone loves being Danny, or like Deshaun, who has great connections with everyone. So I was very much like, yeah, don't go with them. Go with me. Let's get this woman's thing back together. To Deshaun, same thing. I'm like, you know, they're going to turn on you. Let's, you know, we got to turn on them. And then also I do have a great conversation with Erica, which also like the Erica, Heather, ultimately Erica, Xander, Ricard, Heather, that thing is also like percolating in the now. And I really wanted to be part of that also, because obviously I want to like shift the power around. But Erica and I have a great conversation about like this whole thing has to blow apart. So it felt like it was right there, Rob. It was like,
You have this draw, and I think you and I spoke about this in the exit interview. Did you know immediately this was a bad draw?
Oh, yeah. I mean, yeah. I was like, this is absolutely the worst case scenario. And I knew
Danny,
like
Danny Deshaun, you, Xander, Liana.
Exactly. And I knew that Xander was going to win the challenge also. Like, this is just such a Xander challenge, and he has the idol. Like, instantly horrible. Horrible.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That when Shan and Danny and Deshaun and Liana are working together, that is it sort of like did they keep the Black Alliance a secret from the other players, like in Big Brother this summer, like the cookout, like worked very, very hard to like really hide that they were working together. I feel like this really wasn't talked about a lot in the show, whether it was sort of like a secret or everybody kind of knew that was an alliance.
Right. So yeah, I think they did keep it pretty. I mean, it was clear they were working together, but I definitely did not know that it was explicitly like, we're going to do a Black alliance and have it mean something like deep, you know, because in my head, it was always them and Ricard. Like I didn't see, I always thought it was like Shan, Ricard, Shan, Liana, Danny, Deshaun, and all the five of them together. So in my head, I just didn't think about it in that way.
Because you had also just seen Shan and Deshaun get into a big fight at Tribal Council. Exactly. And it wasn't like that, that was theater.
Exactly. So I very much thought about it from the original like tribal lines. And so I think that's something that obviously, if I had known how deep that was, it obviously makes a lot more sense why Danny and Deshaun weren't down to flip on Liana at the point where I was trying to get them to, you know, because I'm thinking like, yeah, obviously this is like an alliance with like Liana. You know what I mean? I wasn't thinking about it in that way, you know?
Okay, now Evvie, you teased me earlier that you had some stories about the stew. You got
It's not so much a story. I just want you to, it wasn't really stew. It was kind of a soup. That's my hot take.
It was more soup than stew.
More soup than stew.
You totally undersold the soup.
Yeah. Well, and also, honestly, the stew was part of my problem. Okay. Because all of this was just the worst case scenario.
Stew the food or stew the guy who makes the pizza?
Well, that too. I mean, I got a lot of heat for eating the pizza.
Yes. Okay.
No, but okay. So we go, you know, I have this horrible draw. Then we go back to camp and it's raining. Yeah. Which is like horrible for scrambling because there's like no reason why anyone is separate because we're all trying to be under the shelter. And we have to freaking like cook this stew. So we have to all be together and like make a fire, boil the water, throw the stuff in. We like do this like crazy thing where we like retake the tarp off the shelter and put it over the flame to cook the stew. Like so much freaking time is spent on the stew situation that it takes even further away from like the potential scramble opportunities. Mm-hmm. So it just like was a horrible setup for me.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay.
But it was good. It honestly was really good.
Mm-hmm. The carrots and onions and hearty potatoes, warm broth.
I mean, yeah. And he was literally like, we would talk about food all the time on Yasa, and it was like the thing that Xander was dreaming of was like a hearty stew. So I'm happy for him.
Yeah. Okay. And it was good.
It honestly was really good. But that was so annoying because then I got voted out and I'm supposed to be so excited to eat, but I wasn't even freaking hungry because I had eaten all this soup.
Yeah. Okay. So at the time you were really trying to work on Deshaun to try to get him to go after Liana there. Was there any other like direction you could have gone, or that was it?
I mean, I think that was it. And what's so like, I feel like it's hard to see because obviously people saw my like longevity with Xander, but it's like at this moment, I felt of those people the most comfortable with Deshaun, which obviously did not turn out to be like, he didn't go with me.
And Xander was immune, right?
Xander was immune. Okay. So like, obviously if it could have been Xander, I would have tried to put it on Xander.
Right.
But it can't be Xander. And so what I really wanted to happen was to get, it's like so obvious to me that like the, like Shan and Liana and Danny and Deshaun are gonna split apart any freaking second. So I really wanted to get them firing at each other. So like the path was try to get Danny and Deshaun to vote for Liana and try to get Liana to vote for one of them. That's what I was like really, really hoping would happen. And because in that case, if like one of those doesn't work out, then it could be a tie or something like that. But honestly, like we didn't talk about the extra vote at all. And that is just, that's obviously a mistake because that would have been the clear way out of that situation. But I just, Xander and I just didn't have the like relationship anymore. You know what I mean? Like where we were like talking through all the scenarios, like we were talking, but I didn't know how much I could trust him at all. Like it was just tense.
Do you think he would have considered it? Because he kind of doesn't really use it in a meaningful way.
I think he would have. I think the thing is, we just honestly believed Danny and Deshaun, but like, I think if we had talked about it, he might have done it. So, I mean, that's obviously a mistake on my part, but it's like, it just, if it was my extra vote, I'm sure I would have thought about it, but it was just like,
Because refresh my memory. So, so they came up for Xander. So you and Xander, you had two votes on Liana. They had three votes on you, but it would have been a third vote on Liana if he played his extra vote and made it a 3-3 tie.
Right.
And then if it's still a deadlock 3-3 tie, now you're immune.
Right.
And Liana is immune. And what, Danny and Deshaun would be in a rock draw?
Exactly, which would be like obviously perfect. So wow. I mean, but I think what would have happened is if it had gotten to that situation, I think they would have flipped on Liana. Like, I don't think they were gonna go to rocks. So that's where Xander could have really done the like power move of like, I'm gonna play my extra vote, so you have to vote the way I want you to vote. Which I think is what he says that he did ultimately when he did use the extra vote.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, we didn't even talk about it, honestly. Like, and I mean, part of it was like I said, like me and Xander had such a strained relationship at this point that I was just really trying to get him to stay with me. And I felt like trying to like force it. Like I didn't ask him for the idol. Like I did like, and cause I was like, he's not going to do that for me. You know what I mean? Like, and so I didn't want him to feel even more alienated for me by trying to like force him to do something he didn't want to do. But obviously like, I wish I had, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. And so you're out of the game now. I'm really interested to know your experience of watching the rest of the game play out from the jury.
Yes. And so, yeah, I really liked your setup because I honestly think like, especially as a super fan, it was a really fun spot to be in. I mean, obviously I was super sad that I was out, but then I really did get to experience the whole end game of the season from, you know, a front row seat, but also, you know, as a juror. So it was really fun. To have that. And so just to set up, like coming out of finding out that, you know, I was voted out and then Nasir was voted out, I was feeling like, because I thought that I didn't realize how much Nasir felt like he was with Shan and Ricard. I thought that he knew that he was like at the bottom of, and so I thought that if you see in my Ponderosa, like I asked Nasir, did Shan play her idol? Which like doesn't make sense in terms of what actually happened. But I thought that like Nasir, Erica, and Heather would try to pull over, like try to get out either Shan or Ricard, because that just like, they were clearly the power, you know, two of the power people in the game. So when Nasir got voted out, I was thinking, oh my God, is Shan just gonna run this game all the way to the end? Like, is this just gonna be like super boring? Shan, you know, just steamrolls to the end of the game.
Mm-hmm.
And the three of us, me, Tiffany, and Nasir, were like that whole day joking, like that Erica is definitely the next one out. Like, cause we were like, oh, she didn't flip on Shan. So like, she's just going to be passive and like get out next. And then Shan's going to run this game.
Mm-hmm.
So then when Erica obviously doesn't get out and Shan does get out, like I feel like I was the earliest adopter of like Erica's playing a really good game of the
game. Yeah.
Because it was very, very clear to me that Erica was the target. I mean, and the target, and obviously Shan and Liana voted for Erica in the one where Shan obviously went home. So I mean, to me, this is like where the Erica game really takes off.
Yeah. You know? Now, it's interesting with the Nasir thing where I look at the Nasir vote as being like more of Ricard's move. It seems like that Nasir didn't even feel like at the time that that was more a Ricard move.
Yeah. I guess so. But I mean, to me, it's really an Erica Heather move, right? Because like, I mean, and surely Ricard was involved in it, but like, I feel like the person it benefited the most was Erica and Heather, because I mean, it would have been Heather going home otherwise. And Heather is Erica's number one ally in the game. So, I didn't really, not knowing exactly how that went down, I was thinking this was like, because Danny and Deshaun always wanted to get Nasir out. They were like, he's this huge threat. We need to get him out. So I thought that Shan was just like fine letting Nasir go. I didn't know how much she felt like she had him in her pocket for a while.
Mm-hmm.
So, but in retrospect, I mean, I do think the people that benefited the most was Erica and Heather. Cause I think Nasir was with Ricard and Shan. Like, I think that's who he trusted the most.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. So, and then when Shan comes out, was there just like a lot of consensus like building in the jury for Erica?
No, I don't think in general. Like, I think it was when Shan got out, it was kind of a wide open playing field. Because what's so interesting, obviously watching it back, the narrative from that point on in the game was very much like Ricard is the number one threat. But I don't feel like that was quite how we saw it at that time, like until he started really like winning all the challenges and things. Mm-hmm. Because knowing how much the fracture between Shan and Deshaun had been building for the entire, you know, merge, I thought that I attributed the Shan vote in my head more to like Deshaun flipping, which obviously is the truth, because without Deshaun and Danny flipping, there is no Shan blindside, right? And Ricard, of course, as well. Like all of those pieces are necessary. But the heat was like so much on Deshaun for doing that, that like in my head, that was a Deshaun. I was thinking about it from Deshaun's perspective more. But then like, so to me, I was like, maybe Deshaun should win this game at that moment. But then when it became so clear that from that moment on, he lost all his power in the game. You know what I mean? I guess what I'm trying to say is, I feel like that move could have been an amazing Deshaun move if he had owned it more. You know what I mean? Because it's like everyone saw it as Shan versus Deshaun. And then Shan gets out. So like, how easy would it be for Deshaun? And he had such a good relationship with Erica, with Heather. Like if he had just been like proud of it, I feel like he could have like been part of the group remaining forward. But instead he felt so much guilt about like the Black Alliance. And like at that tribal council, he's all about like, was Ricard lying to me? Like, I feel like if he had just gone full steam ahead of like, Shan needed to get out because she was going to win this game, and I was part of that move, he could have been the one who like benefited from that. Does that make sense?
Yes. As a juror, like, what are you looking for? Is it sort of like just like what you hear at tribal council, or are you trying to like interview the other people as they're coming out of the game to get like a sense of what was going on back at the beach?
Right. Yeah, I mean, for me, I really wanted to know like who is driving the votes, you know, in these, you know, I was always going to vote for the person who I thought played the best game. You know what I mean? It wasn't going to be who to like the most, right? Like it was always going to be who do I think deserves to win, you know? And so coming off that vote, it was like, okay, who is in power now? Okay, clearly Deshaun has lost a lot of power. And it seems like now this group of like Ricard, Xander, Heather, Erica is in power. So my kind of question going forward was, within that foursome, who has the power? You know, like who's deciding who they're actually voting for? Mm-hmm. And so for me, I'd say the turning point in my head, and I think for a lot of the jury, I think the second truth bomb vote, the final six vote, was very, very integral to the Erica respect.
Yeah.
Because so many things I feel like went in Erica's favor on that. Like, obviously the truth bomb made Deshaun, I feel like, look bad because it's just like, what are you doing? And it really like fell into the narrative that Shan really had about Deshaun of like, you're emotional, like all that, you know, it made him look a little like, I want to take my ball and go home rather than get voted out. You know what I mean? Like, and it was just like, what is the point of that? So like that diminished Deshaun. Also Erica's response to it was amazing. I really thought, especially like, you know, as a non-man in the world, like I felt like she was just like very powerful in her response of like, why did you do that? And there was a little bit more, like I remember Deshaun said, I think Erica said to him like, well, clearly Deshaun views me as a big threat because he's like truth bombing me. And Deshaun was like, I don't view you as a threat. Like something a little like, again, I love Deshaun, but it came off as like obnoxious, I thought. And Erica was just so good at responding to that. And like, I'd been on the receiving end of a Deshaun truth bomb and I know how horrible that feels. And I just felt like she handled it really, really well.
Yeah.
So like, that's a point for Erica. And then the fact that it was this split between Danny and Deshaun, and in that tribal, it had been said that Ricard wanted it to be Deshaun, but it was Danny. And so to me, I know that also that Erica has a good relationship with Deshaun. I know that that apparently Ricard wants Deshaun to go home. I know that Xander loves Danny and has a good relationship with Danny, but Danny goes home. So to me, all of this was like Erica ran this vote. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And then what did she say at the end? She's like, you know, thank you, friend.
Thank you, friend. Like, yeah, exactly. Like all of that played so well, I thought. And like Deshaun literally came in and was like, I mean, whatever. Like, I don't have any power anymore. Like, it just like was such a bad look. And she came off so well that I feel like that for a lot of people was like, okay, like Erica really like has a lot of power in this group.
Okay. Evvie, from watching the show, it felt like, okay, this is Ricard's game to win. If Ricard gets to the end, he wins against anybody. If Ricard was there with Erica, do you have a feeling of how that vote would have gone?
Yeah, I mean, I mean, obviously it's like, I would have to imagine the world therefore where it means that Ricard won the final four immunity challenge probably. And, you know, like there would probably be more moves on Ricard that would make it like even you know, stronger for him. But I would say, I mean, I really thought Erica was playing really well. So I know that Erica would have gotten consideration. Like, I don't think it would have been 100% Ricard if it had been the two of them together. I think, you know, what's interesting, like, I feel like in a lot of seasons, there's a split between the first couple of jurors and the final couple of jurors in terms of like who they vote for, you know?
Yeah.
Like in David Goliath, a lot of the end jurors voted Mike White.
Ghost Island, like his best example. Yeah.
Right. And so I think that the end jurors, like I think Danny and Deshaun, if Deshaun had been on the jury, and probably Xander, if Xander had been on the jury, like I think they would have all voted for Ricard, but it just didn't translate as much watching just because like, again, like, obviously he won the challenges, but that thing of like that the challenges are not in front of the jury, but then we get to all these votes and it just seemed to me like Erica was driving the votes. You know, like I'm not, I honestly, like maybe Ricard would have won, but for me personally, it wasn't like so obvious. And also Erica was like amazing at Final Tribal. So it would also depend on how that went down. But I don't think you could rule out that Erica could have made a very good case for herself even against Ricard, you know?
Okay. All right, so Erica ends up winning. She wins 7-1-0.
Yes.
And we go right into Evvie live reunion show.
Oh my God. Well, can I also tell you one thing, like, which I don't know if you heard this already. Maybe Erica told you in her exit interview, but like, so I think going into that tribal, like Erica was the favorite probably, but I think she did pick up even more votes at the tribal. And I think the one vote she definitely won from tribal was Nasir, because Nasir and her did not get along very well, apparently, at Luzu. And at the end of, you know, when Jeff is like, okay, jury, do you feel good? Do you feel like it's time to vote? Nasir just like shouts out like, Erica, I promised you I would never vote for you, but I'm changing that tonight. I'm voting for you.
Wow.
And Jeff is like, okay, no one else say who you're voting for. Like, please stop this. But it was really cool because I feel like he was the person probably least likely to vote for her. And then he did like announce to everyone that he was going to.
Yeah. Did you have an inkling that they might reveal the votes in Fiji?
No, I mean, I definitely not. But then like when Jeff starts saying like, we're going to do something, it was like, whoa. But it was so exciting. Like I can't, waiting to know who wins must suck so much. Like I was so happy to just get right into it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, like it sucks so much if you're in the final three, I think, you know, if you knew who you voted for, it's like, I don't think it sucks that bad.
I guess that's true.
Yeah. So maybe like for, you know, for Erica, I guess like, you know, you won and then, but then it's like, I can't spend any of this money.
Right. Right. But at least you know for sure that you, that you will have it one day. Yeah.
Yeah. So, all right. We get to our, live reunion show. And again, this was a surprise also.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Oh, completely.
And Evvie, did you feel like I was singling you out about the pizza?
No. It was more that I was just laughing at myself because I was just like, to be fair, okay, we probably left for tribal at like 4:30 or something. Yeah. At this point, it's probably like 9 or 10, like, or, you know, like it was a long time, but also it's Survivor. Like we've all dealt with hunger before, but it was more just like, I'm like watching me eat pizza on TV being like, why the fuck am I just wait? Like
my thing was that, I don't know why, anybody, thought this was a good idea to see people eating pizza on TV. Yeah.
Right. It was funny because I feel like Jeff really wanted to keep, like, he kept like also like as like the producers and stuff are like coming in with the pizza and with the backdrop, he's doing that thing of like, this is the finale. Blah, blah. Like, I feel like he wanted to like keep the vibe of live finale, but it wasn't live. So, it was
but
just,
they
like,
don't eat pizza, the real finale.
Right. True. I don't know, man. I really don't know.
I don't even know if they have pizza in the green room.
Yeah. I really don't know what to tell you. It was crazy. Like, I really, especially for Xander and Deshaun, just felt so bad. Like, I just feel like they just came off of like, they went into tribal thinking they had a shot and they just lost like in a blowout. Like, it just sucked that they had to sit there and like couldn't process it and had to like answer questions right away. Like, I just really felt for them. Yeah.
Evvie, did you ever meet Stu who makes the pizza?
I did not. I didn't even remember that Jeff said that. That whole thing was so, I'm so glad you highlighted. That was so funny. Like, if you're just tuning in and like, imagine how weird that was for us who like,
Not been
experiencing it as a TV show.
Yeah.
You know, it's just like so random. Like, yeah, I don't know. It's so funny.
How long was the reunion show? Was that basically just pretty much like what we saw was what we got?
No, I think it was a bit longer. Like, I think there was a bit more of rehashment of the like Deshaun Shan thing a lot more. And I'm pretty happy that they didn't feel a need to like, I feel like the point was made and like, it just like was hard to like keep having that rehash. So I think that was probably for the best.
Yeah.
But I mean, mostly it was there. I mean, I'll just say Tiffany and Heather will never let me forget that I said later years.
I don't know if I fall down in the later years. I think it's pretty close. Yeah.
That's just the sentiment I was trying to say was how badass these women are. Mm-hmm. And I'm just like, this is why I didn't. Extemporaneous.
Hold on. You could take that. You were on a real roll, and then you kind of
said, "You said this is
yeah, this is." You said this is, and you were about to say something.
This is why I didn't think I was going on a show where I was supposed to be drinking on TV. Like I don't say the right things when champagne is involved. So yes, I was trying to say how badass they were, and I said later years, and I literally like the entire rest of the night they were ragging on me for that. So I regret it. I regret it.
Yeah. Okay. It was a fun moment, and yes. It was, you know, an interesting show. Did you feel like, you know, like that, hey, we did something cool that nobody else did, or it was too bad we couldn't have had the live reunion show?
Yeah. I mean, I just feel like in the moment I thought it was cool. Like, I mean, I felt bad for the final three, but I was like, this was kind of fun. And like, it's also was kind of interesting to think about, like, cause obviously I'm starting to think about, you know, what's the edit going to be and all that. And so it was like interesting to like think about the questions that Jeff just asked us and then try to piece together like how the show is going to, you know what I mean? What they're for, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So it was interesting in that way. But then now having watched the show, there's just so many other things that I wish could have been discussed that, didn't, you know, like for me, like, I feel like a huge moment in my game was like my final words and the shout out I gave to like the queer kids. And like, obviously I didn't even know that that was a moment because, you know what I mean? So it's like stuff like that. Like, and I think everybody probably has their thing that, you know, these like meta moments that I just, you know,
well, what if we could have had that now? What if they said, all right, Evvie, we got to talk about your final words. You know, you shout out to all the queer kids that were out there watching the show. What has been the response from the people on the streets?
Yeah, the people on the streets. Yeah, the people on Instagram. Yeah. But no, honestly, I mean, what was so cool about that to me is like when I went on the show, I had like a theoretical proposition of like, it would be meaningful to me if I was a younger queer person to see me on TV and like, how cool would that be? And if I touch, you know, one person by just being on the show, that will, you know, be everything. And then getting to actually like say that message. And I just received like floods of, you know, positive feedback on that. And it was just like, it is the moment I'm like proudest of the whole game. And so like, it's very, very special to me. And I just feel really happy that it did, connected people.
Well, just like as an observer, you know, I've seen so many people, you know, flock to you on social media, and that you've been like, such a, you know, a powerful influence for people that, you know, can identify and empathize with your personal experience, like, you know, on and off the show. So that must be incredible.
Yeah, no, it really is. And like also something that would have been cool to talk about that like hadn't like happened in my life is, you know, that I realized I was like thinking about my gender identity more when I was on the show and like really like mid game had this realization of like, oh, I really think I'm non-binary. And like, that's something that, you know, like on all the questions that I was getting about like my bow tie and like talking about like the women of Yasa, like just became, it was like, oh yeah. Like that's what I'm experiencing is like that, there's been this issue that I just really haven't dealt with about my gender. And like, I had a lot of, when I came home, I was like, okay, I talked to my partner, I talked to my friends and was like, okay, yes, that's what's happening. I'm non-binary. I'm like genderqueer. Like that's what's happening for me. And then I felt this like insane pressure of like, this is so weird that I like realized this about myself, but I just filmed this TV show where I'm like not talking about this and where everyone's using she pronouns. And like, I just had a lot of anxiety of like, are people going to understand it? Are people, are non-binary people going to be like sad that I didn't talk about it on the show? Like, are just like, you know, it was a weird situation to be like uncovering my own identity and being like imminently about to be a public person, you know? Mm-hmm. But it's something that I feel like was received so well, like, you know, by the vast majority. Obviously, there's always like horrible people, but like, I feel like so many people understood it, like listened to my story, you know, started using different pronouns. Like, I really thank you, like, for, I feel like you often were using like they and bringing it up, and like Mike Bloom like DM'd me before the pregame interviews came out. And like, I just like really am grateful to you all for doing that. And
Thank you very much. And I feel like, you know, I do feel like that, you know, most of us who are talking about the show, I feel like want to try to get it right and want to try to, you know, give people like refer to people in the ways that they want to be referred to. And I'm so happy to hear that you didn't get any sort of, you know, negative, you know, feedback from people in the community. From, you know, your own lived experience. I think that probably people probably identify of like, that's probably similar to their own experience of like that they, you know, had this evolution about themselves.
Exactly. And I mean, just to say, it's not like I got no negative feedback. I mean,
no, okay, sure. Yeah. But, I get plenty.
Of course. Yeah. But no, I mean, and I think what was cool about it is like, you know, I felt this pressure of like, I need to like nail this down. Like, I wish I had known this before. And then I was like, but the truth is that I realized it then, and I am like open about it now. And like, that will just be more impactful because it's the truth. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And like, I feel like people do resonate with, it is a journey, and you can always learn new pieces about yourself and like discover more about yourself. And so I feel like it's awesome that I was able to just be open about like, hey, this is something that I realized about myself after. And I, you know, I'm happy to get to be the person. And I hope that one day someone goes on the show and is already realizes that, because I think that would be very, very cool.
I mean, I don't think that we're going to have to wait too long.
Yeah.
I think it's gonna, yeah. You know, in the next couple of years, I think we're going to see. And you talked about, you know, being a part of a season with, you know, so much representation. I think that you were a big part of it yourself.
Thank you. Yeah. I mean, again, I just feel so honored. And I think also the really cool thing is that, you know, I was going into thinking like, oh, I'm going to be the queer person. But it's like, no, there was me and there was Ricard and there was Jeannie. And like, we're all in the LGBTQ community and we're all different and have different experiences. So I feel like that is a really cool thing when you don't just have like one person of a type. You know, I got to be a person and Ricard gets to be a person. And, you know, I just think that's great.
Evvie, I know you're very busy with work and everything. Have you given any thought to potentially going back to Fiji to deface another book at the Ponderosa?
Yeah. Oh, I mean, of course. I would definitely go back. I mean, I do feel like, I don't know. I think the chances that I do worse are pretty high. Like, I think with someone like me, I feel like my game is revealed, you know, a little bit. Like, people see that I have a lot of like social and strategic skill, but also like, I mean, presumably in an all-star season, everybody has, you know, a great game that has been mm-hmm. to some degree. So I would love it. I mean, it was a really, really fun thing to do. So hell yeah.
Yeah. I mean, just to like do the thought exercise, you know, certainly like, I think that people will like look at you, as a threat. And, you know, I feel like these are the kinds of conversations I have with, you know, like a Christian Hubicki of like, right. sort of like somebody who, but you're also the kind of person that's like can work with everybody. And I right. feel like that, sure, you know, you could go after them, but like, there's other people that you don't get along with.
Right, exactly. Like me, come on, you know, I like, and I also do think like, there's definitely, I think, you know, like you look at like the first All-Stars where it was like, let's take
do we have to?
Yeah. But I think you're, you know, it was like right away, we got to get out the big threats, the Rob Cesternino, mm-hmm. the Richard Hatches, you know, but I do think the next evolution in the All-Star strategy is the, like, let's keep the lions together to, you know, stop the hyenas or whatever, like the Tony strategy. So I do think like, I'm not the meat shield that you might think, but I'm a different, you know, if there's a season with me and Christian and, you know, mm-hmm. like, you can imagine, you know, that version of lions or whatever. So, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. If there's big enough threats, there's big enough threats. Right. Where, you know, it's like the problem is, I think, when they have a season that's not balanced, where right. like a game changer, where you yeah. have like, okay, oh, you have like eight threats, but maybe, you know, nine not threats, right. you know, right. and a couple people in the middle.
You know, unknown threats. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. It makes it very easy to sort of like, you know, pick off the people that are sort of the bigger targets. Evvie, what about outside of Survivor? Anything besides work cool that you're working on?
Mostly just working. I've been having so much fun on Cameo, by the way. That's not
yes.
just, like, it's just like actually is so fun to get to like hear from people that are, you know, it's just like it's a really, really fun thing. I know you actually, by the way, I got a Cameo from you for my friend.
You got a Cameo from me for your friend.
Yeah, I requested it for my friend.
When
yeah.
was this?
It was probably during season 40. You had the
my stick figure.
Yes.
My I don't have anybody from season 41, but I have like.
What are you doing?
Yeah.
Well, it's I don't know if you remember from the wand off DJ Mazzy Maz.
Okay.
He's one of my close friends. And so we got her a Cameo and it was fun from you. And I just, it's very, very fun to get to connect with fans like that. So
mm-hmm.
I love that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but that's it. That
Evvie, we need you back. I got another pizza for you. Stu's waiting for you. Come on out here. That's how you do it, Survivor fans.
Drop the four, keep the one.
Yeah.
By the way, the monster.
Yes. Monster.
The first time we heard the first time that I heard the phrase of like the monster was at that reunion show. He said mm-hmm. that to me and he's like, we realized this is like a monster. And I was like, okay. And then yeah. that became an
run
all
with
the
it.
Emotional stuff. And then it's like completely not in the season at all. It's so funny.
I think somebody must have just been kicking that around. Like, yeah, let's run with that. Yeah, that'll be part of the whole marketing of the season.
Yeah, but they really let it go, right? Like, I don't know.
Did you know that Jeff was talking to the camera? Did you know Jeff was breaking the fourth wall?
No, I mean, obviously I knew that moment where he said, like, that's how you do it. Like, mm-hmm. but I thought that I was like, oh my God, I mean, Jeff breaks the fourth wall. Little do I know, that's his shtick this season.
Yes. Okay. Did you ever notice a game within the game?
No idea. I think that was cute how it connected with their final word scramble thing.
Mm-hmm.
That was
I guess
cute.
So.
Yeah.
anything else about watching the season back that was fun?
I mean, it just was a riot. Like,
you made a lot of fun TikToks during the season.
It's true. And I tried to like, I didn't make them too Survivor related because I didn't want to accidentally, you know, spoil or anything.
Right.
I really love the social media stuff. I don't know if you saw, my Instagram was recently hacked and then I got it back and it was.
I saw your message that my Instagram has been hacked. Yes.
Yes. So that was stressful, but I got it back. But I honestly I don't know how much I'm going to do social media, but it's really fun. It's a really fun way to get to like actually directly connect with fans and stuff. So yeah, I've been enjoying mm-hmm. it.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, there are some real jerks out there, and they're not the kind of people that listen to 3 hours of deep dive exactly. podcasts. But
the
community is very is for the most part like is very fun and very warm and engaging, and they really just you know love having fun with the people that we get to know from the shows.
Exactly, and that's so fun because it's like that's you know I was thinking you know it's sad that it's ending, but it's also like. I'm still part of this community, you know, and like
you're stuck with us forever,
and you guys are stuck with me, so mm-hmm. I'm into it.
Yeah,
I'm into it.
Okay. Yeah. And are you interested in now going back to watching the show for season 42?
Yes, definitely. I will say I'm pretty relieved that it is far away. Like I think I did need a little bit of a break. Like mm-hmm. It's nice that it's in March for me, but I'm definitely very excited. Can't wait. I'm sure it's going to be an amazing, you know, yes. amazing cast again.
Do you watch any of the other CBS reality shows?
Not so much the CBS one. Like I've seen some Amazing Race and stuff like that, yeah. but I haven't really watched them. I have to say I'm a big Real Housewives person.
Okay.
I'm a few weeks behind on Salt Lake City, but I love the post-show recaps.
Oh yes. Yeah. Maggie and Jacob. On
yes.
The
they're hilarious. Yeah. Yes.
Oh, that's great.
I love it. So that's where I feel like I needed a break from competition shows and I'm.
Yeah. Do you watch anything else that's not reality?
I was a big Succession person.
Yes, yes.
Big Lost person. I used to listen to Down the Hatch. Yes. Which I enjoyed a lot. I honestly, I watch a lot of TV. That's okay. Especially, you know, it's like, it's quarantine. What else are you going to do?
Mm-hmm.
I like the reality. I mean, Bachelor. I like the brand, the candy, you know, like.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. It's fun. All right, Evvie. What a ride we went on today.
Truly, truly.
I'm so glad you made the time to do this.
I'm literally seriously so happy. Like, what listening to Rob as a podcast was an integral part of my getting into Survivor. So I really am really, really grateful for you. And this
that makes me very happy to hear you say that.
Yeah, no, it's so good. And the evolution strategy is truly amazing. Although, yeah, I have to, I feel like as I was watching it, I had some like notes. So, you know,
yes.
I never want to the whole thing again.
Are they in your notebook, in your journal?
They're on my notes app. They're on my notes app.
Yeah, dear Carmel, let me tell you about another thing that Rob screwed up.
What an idiot, that guy.
What an idiot. that this guy's takes are colder than the... a bomb
older
cyclone.
Than Survivor, yes. Pizza, yeah.
Yes. All right. Well, Evvie, thank you again. Where can people follow you to get see what you're doing on Cameo?
Yes. So I'm on Cameo and on Instagram. Which my Instagram, it's back. It's me, and it's Evvie back. Jag, Evvie Jag. And I think on Twitter I'm Evvie Jagoda. You'll find.
Mm-hmm.
And I like being on those places.
What about TikTok?
TikTok Evvie Jag as well.
Okay.
Love the TikToks.
Yeah. The TikTok is fun. I slowed down on the TikTok. I was really, yeah. I was all in on the TikTok. And then once I moved, I was not TikToking enough.
You guys lean very heavily on the like mouth moving over an image.
Too much? Is it too
much? Yeah, too much. I think you can do better.
Okay. All right. We'll take that note internally and see what we can do. Okay. Yeah. All right. Evvie, well, this was super fun for me. And I hope that you'll come back and talk Survivor 42 with us.
I would love that. Love that.
Okay. All right. Well, Evvie, great job here. To everybody else, hope you're around for our amazing race coverage. So what about Celebrity Big Brother, Evvie? Will you check that out?
Maybe I will. I mean, I have never watched a whole Big Brother season, but
it's a short one. This is a short run.
Oh, is it shorter for Celebrity? Okay.
Celebrity, it's like 2.5 weeks.
Is it celebrities, or what are we talking about?
I think you know what we're talking.
Gotcha.
Like, yeah. All right, here's Stu, who he makes the pizza on Survivor.
Right, big celebrity.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah. Okay, maybe I'll check it out.
Yeah. All right. Of course, for everybody else, robhasawebsite.com/subscribe so you don't miss any of the fun. Evvie, thank you again. And we'll hopefully have some more Survivor 41 interviews coming your way. Take care, everybody. Have a good one. Bye.
Thanks, Rob.